Ladies and gentlemen, it is September 22nd, 2016, on this Thursday edition, 46 days out from the most historic election in U.S. history, perhaps world history. Soros and the globalists are activating race war destabilization programs across the country and the world. We have massive other developments, and Hillary now had a psychotic breakdown in a video link to supporters. It's all unraveling. But first, a report on Hillary.
Are you voting for your party's nominee, Governor?
I am proud of Hillary Clinton. I think she's been a very good Secretary of State, a very good senator from the state of New York. The thing I like most about her is I believe that she is steady. I believe that she is strong. I believe that she is honest. And I look forward to voting for her.
Her speeches are so short, though. They don't last long. You know, they're like 10 minutes, let's get out of here. Go back home and go to sleep.
While Hillary slept, the sleeping giant was awakening, presenting himself in a downpour in front of a hearty crowd of Trump supporters in historic Williamsburg, Virginia. Republican vice presidential candidate Mike Pence delivered a rousing patriotic speech.
But you know, it's not just weakness on the world stage. But Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton are all wet on the economy, too. And the truth is, men and women, as we stand here in Virginia, we hear sunny stories all the time coming from the other side about how good things are. But the truth of the matter is, the American people know different. We're in the midst of the slowest economic recovery since the Great Depression. We're in the midst of an economy that has the lowest labor participation rate since the 1970s. And today, in this economy, there are nearly 7 million more Americans living in poverty than the day that Barack Obama became president of the United States. Hillary Clinton's solution is very simple. More of the same. More taxes. More regulation. More Obamacare. And more of the war on coal that's been stifling American jobs and the American economy.
Democratic vice presidential nominee Tim Kaine was catering to an entirely different audience.
Hola, Piolín. Soy el senador Tim Kaine, tu candidato a la vicepresidencia junto a mi amiga Hillary Clinton.
Kaine was flexing Spanish-speaking skills he had utilized back in the 1980s when Kaine traveled to Honduras to cut his teeth on the wielding of Marxist-based liberation theology. The Hill wrote, reports indicate that in Honduras, Mr. Kaine embraced an interpretation of the gospel known as liberation theology. This wasn't mainstream Catholic thought at the time. It was a radical Marxist-based ideology at odds with the church, the Pope, and the United States, but supportive of and supported by the Soviet Union. Pence and Kaine will face off in a vice presidential debate on Tuesday, October 4th.
Do you feel bad for Mike Pence that he has to defend, like...
I mean,
because he's got to be constantly like, oh, no, what do I say now? What did he say now?
It is part of the role. I don't find that a heavy lift at all to do the work I have to do to tell people Hillary's story.
Meanwhile, Tim Kaine, Chelsea Clinton, and Bill Clinton all fill in for a clearly sick Hillary, who managed to schedule a rally in Orlando, Florida at the last minute after being heavily criticized for her absence to the campaign trail before the big showdown between Hillary and Donald on Monday, September 26th.
3 days later, she gets up and she does another one and goes back home and goes to sleep. Oh, boy, is ISIS hoping for her.
Meanwhile, Republican presidential candidate Donald Trump continues to steam through Toledo, Ohio, Chester Township, Pennsylvania, and Roanoke, Virginia before the big event. A conservative leader wrote the Gateway Pundit Wednesday morning to share this news, hearing smart guys say that Hillary may cancel the debate on Monday. Hillary may be trying to run out the clock because she thinks she is ahead, or she may be exhausted and scared of another physical emergency. If Hillary manages to not cancel Monday's debate, she now has a full 4 days off to set up a defense for the onslaught of questions she will have to answer to concerning her long criminal history.
I mean, many in the national media spend more time talking about what Donald Trump said in the last 30 minutes than they do talking about what the Clintons have been up to for the last 30 years, but the American people are on to them.
John Bound for Infowars.com.
Ladies and gentlemen, Hillary Clinton is breaking down. Video straight ahead. these other minions of this planetary corporate takeover, that is their legacy, is reawakening the sleeping giant that is free humanity and the nation state. We certainly know that governments constituted by men always become corrupt over time and have their problems, and there's a balance between government and free individual rights. And I personally want to have the very smallest, most limited government possible. But only an incredibly moral people could be truly in an anarchy-based system, and that doesn't exist. And as we become more and more corrupt, more and more evil, more and more decadent, more and more disconnected, more and more entitled, by extension, that will manifest a bigger and bigger government to control the population. And that bigger and bigger government will become more and more corrupt itself, accelerating us into a cycle of collapse. And we are undoubtedly entering the very depths of that right now. We are entering the gates of hell. The roller coaster is going over the edge right now and getting ready to do the loop de loop, the up to the top just stopped, and things are about to get crazy. In fact, they're already getting crazy, obviously. Wow. Hillary Clinton, Washington Post is reporting, drudgereport.com has it linked centrally up on the page. Hillary Clinton is acting more and more quirky, more and more insane, more and more like she's having mini seizures, bugging her eyes out and saying, using improper English, coming out and saying, why aren't I 50 points ahead? And when you look at the video of the Secret Service agent running up beside her and saying, it's okay, keep going, keep going. You see her losing reality, losing the connection with reality, and then suddenly flashing back into it. I, unfortunately, in my life have had to deal with someone who was later diagnosed as being psychotic. And they would go into the exact same thing that I see with Hillary Clinton. And those of us that have had to be around this, and it's personal and private, and I'm not going to get into it, understand what it looks like when somebody's eyes completely go into like saucers, and they usually make this little weird smile, and you're like, uh-oh, they're gone. Somebody else is here. And let me tell you, Hillary Clinton is fluxing in and out. All of us do this when we get really angry and blow up. I mean, we're designed to do that, to be able to get upset and motivated. All of us have little psychotic breaks when, you know, you see somebody, let's say, punch your kid in the face. You're going to have a break because you're going to have the normal instincts to defend your young. But when you become, you know, truly psychopathic with massive psychoses, it's when your false world becomes basically the real world to you. And more you check out of the real world and retreat and recede into la-la land. Now, that's a lay analysis of psychotic breaks and people that are in deep psychosis, but it exists. It's real. We've all seen it. We've all experienced it in our lives. Sometimes it's mild. Sometimes someone thinks that they're God or invincible or that demons are coming after them. But more often than not, in the power elite, they become megalomaniacal and very, very angry and very, very entitled. And when someone challenges them or they're not being given what they want, they blow up and throw a big temper tantrum like a three-year-old. Just like what we're seeing in North Carolina, Joe Biggs is on his way there right now. We had hoped that this would cool down, so I didn't really talk about it a lot yesterday. It's a total George Soros operation on paper. I mean, that's admitted. I'm not just saying that. Everybody knows that. He just gave them another $500 million. To the overall destabilization of the borders. Ford Foundation has given them $100 million directly to Black Lives Matter. I mean, this is the foundations that run our country trying to destabilize us. And notice that they didn't pick the poor crutcher guy shot by the lady cop in Tulsa with his car broke down, put his hands up like she said, and then she executes him. Donald Trump's come out and said the lady choked. She shouldn't be on the force. She's clearly got problems. Exact same thing I said 2 days ago and yesterday. Trump didn't get that from me. That's what's happening. That cop didn't want to kill him because he was black. That cop killed him because she was panicked and scared, and there's all this hype about how the black people are going to, you know, kill the cops because you got Soros groups pushing that narrative that she shouldn't be in that position. She can't handle the stress. She killed him. She should be charged with manslaughter. I'm sorry. Just looking at it, the guy followed the orders. His car was broke down. She killed him. And Trump has come out, we're going to play the clip later, and said he's very troubled by Oklahoma fatal police shooting and said, look, the woman clearly choked. She melted down. She couldn't handle it. And that's the type of cops we actually have out there shooting innocent people, is people choking. And I'm sorry, you asked for the hard job. It's a rough job. I try to back good police in general, but you cannot let cops get off that basically execute people through cowardice, whatever you want to call it. But notice that's not being turned into the big cause celeb, whether it was the shooting in Ferguson or shootings in other areas or this new one in North Carolina in Charlotte. It wasn't a book in his hand. The video's out. It's on InfoWars.com. It's a gun. The cops are saying, let go of it. He won't let go of it. There's a guy with a gun in his hand, won't let go of it. They got his hand pinned down, had to shoot him. Black cop shot him, by the way. Black guy shoots a black guy. It's white people's fault. There are white trendies out there. There's Paul Watson wrote about it. It's up on InfoWars.com. He tweeted and made the point. Black man has a gun shot by a black cop. It's white people's fault. Black protester, rioter, shoots another black protester, rioter, and it's white people's fault. No, you got a white woman shooting a black father of, what, four or five kids with no criminal record on his way back from church, I was told. His car breaks down. Cops pull up. They see a big black guy. Woman gets scared. The guy's like, okay, I'll do what you say, and she kills him. But not because she was probably racist, but because she shouldn't have that job and she choked. And Donald Trump gets it exactly right. I said 2 days ago, she choked. I said yesterday, she can't handle it. She freaked out. I didn't use the word he used, choked. That's what's great about Trump. He gets it. He's smart. He understands what's going on. But this situation in North Carolina is like the Gaza Strip now. Army, Humvees, white people begging for their lives, being beaten, white people having their apartments broken into, begging, white people being targeted, white reporters being targeted by racist mobs of black Ku Klux Klan, enabled by the media and the culture. We have family members of the black guy that got shot by a black cop saying white people, I have the quote right here, Keith Lamont Scott's brother calls all white people devils. And then there's all these little sycophantic white people running around behind, oh, I'm sorry, I'm evil. Here, I have a sign, whites are evil. I mean, I saw the signs. As long as there's white violence, we're going to continue to have these problems. Or, you know, white corruption is the cause. I mean, I saw all these signs by weirdo white people out there when it's a black cop shooting a black guy with a gun in the middle of the street. Again, this is all outside organized, outside coordinated, outside manipulated to become the urban culture. Whether you're black, white, it doesn't matter. Where you're a victim, everyone's out to get you, but the local Democratic government's your friend against their own very police because they're busy bringing the UN in under strong cities to federalize them. Doesn't matter if your unemployment has doubled. It doesn't matter if your society's falling apart. It doesn't matter if your jobs have been shipped overseas. It doesn't matter. Because we've created the perception that there's this epidemic of police going after black people to kill them. The truth is, that's not happening. The truth is, the drug laws have been written to put a predominantly large number of black people in prison. And blacks have been targeted with secret biological testing and abortion and with less funding to the schools and with allowing red light districts in their neighborhoods, but nobody else's. Oh, the truth is there's a conspiracy against black Americans. You better absolutely know it's been declassified. But nobody wants to actually look at that. More and more black leaders actually are that aren't on the globalist payroll. of the Ford Foundation and Margaret Sanger and the usual suspects who admit in their founding charters, we are being set up to become the liberals, to make black people trust us, to buy off their leaders so we can kill these weeds. Margaret Sanger, quote, look it up, it's mainstream news. Woman of the Year in Time magazine, I think, three times. Even recently, they gave it to her like a decade ago. The woman was worshipped, I'm skipping this break, by Adolf Hitler. Was given awards by Hitler. She gave awards to Hitler. This is in the late 30s. You say literally Hitler? She's it. Oh, but let's call Donald Trump literally Hitler when there's zero connection. So I can tell you, we're going to break all this down today. We've got big guests coming up as well. Former technical director of the National Security Agency, who is portrayed in the new Snowden movie, will be joining us to give us his take on Snowden. And then we're also going to have former NSA officer and Infowars.com reporter Wayne Madsen on the transmission while Benny's on with me, because he can ask even more expert questions. But it's really interesting to see the truth come out in that movie. It blew me away. So we're going to get into it, because I know some of the things that are in the movie actually haven't been declassified. And that's what really freaked me out. And Benny doesn't want to be SWAT teamed. As he's been SWAT teamed before for even reporting to Congress under law what he knew was going on. But it was very, very interesting to see the film, and I really want to promote it. I have no financial connection to it. I'm just very, 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 very proud of the fact that the information in it is truly powerful, and we'll get it to a general public. But again, to see Nicolas Cage playing William Benny was amazing. So that's all coming up in the second hour. And we'll also continue this discussion of what's happening in Charlotte, North Carolina, into the third and fourth hour today. Anthony Gucciardi is hosting the fourth hour. Before I go any further, though, let's just read some of the headlines, and then I'll get into Hillary's latest break with reality. Let's read some of the headlines from DrudgeReport.com. Thugs of Charlotte. White man dragged, beaten, begged for mercy. Second night of chaos, violence, appeals for calm, state of emergency. Protesters smashing apartment windows on live TV. No, they're looters, they're rioters. NASCAR Hall of Fame looted. Homeless white man kicked over. Rioters go shoe shopping for size. Stolen cash register. Attempt to throw photographer into fire. Victim's brother calls all white people devils. CNN reporter attacked. White man with guns allowed to drive away alive. And that's the point, is to drive through the rioting. Just, hey, here's my gun. Which is a good message. I mean, I can't imagine. I don't care if a group of white people, black people, you're rioting, I'm with my family, you're trying to block my car in, drag me out. I mean, you're going to get aired out real quick. It's so sad, but it's really, really getting pushed, folks. Very, very sad. There's a lot of new polls out we're going to be going over. They're up on Infowars.com and on DrudgeReport.com. Whether it's Rasmussen or the Washington Post polls or other scientific polls being conducted by the LA Times, he is 5 to 10 points ahead and surging. The wave, the Trump wave, the Americana wave, is turning into a tsunami. So we'll be looking at all of that, obviously, and talking about what will the October surprise of Herr Hillary be. By the way, Joel Gilbert is giving us the exclusive, because he's working with members of the Obama family, the cutout family from Kenya. They're not really his family, and they know that now. They are giving us the exclusive tomorrow. You will see the exclusive tomorrow with Joel Gilbert of Obama 2 decades ago, talking absolute total trash about America and saying how much he hates white people. This is dangerous. This is extremely powerful. And let me tell you, I'm crossing my fingers this even gets on air tomorrow, because it's bad. It's going to be huge. It's going to be massive newsmaking. And I appreciate Joel Gilbert sharing this great honor, this great danger with us. But this will premiere tomorrow. Was that in the third hour? On the Friday edition. So be sure and join us for that. Okay. I'm going to put a special report together on this today because it's so important. It needs to go mega viral. We have Hillary Clinton with the shadowy gentleman who they wouldn't say who he was, a medical doctor, Secret Service, shadowing her with the EpiPen a few weeks ago, runs up beside her and says, it's okay. Go back. Everything's okay. Keep talking. You can clearly see Hillary goes out of consciousness to... It has had a psychotic break. It's classic. You can see it. Psychiatrists that have seen it, right, Dr. Pachinik, say clearly she is going into la-la land. Then her handler there tells her, it's okay, and she flips right back into reality. Okay? And there's so many of these videos now, and she'll be on other shows, and people are asking her questions like that veteran did a few weeks ago, saying, hey, I was a Navy veteran. If I did anything you did with secret classified info, I'd be in prison. And she kind of goes from looking nice to instantly rearing forward. And General Flynn, when he introduced Donald Trump at the Congressional Medal of Honor's winner event that was endorsing Trump last week, made the point, we're going to play that in a few minutes, after we play the new Hillary clip, that this is dangerous. This is someone going in and out of reality. This is someone that has huge anger management problems and does not need to be president of the United States, and she's losing her cognitive ability. And General Flynn is one of the top generals ever in intelligence, reorganizing the military, just did wonders for special forces. I mean, he's a general's general. There are a lot of generals, and a lot of them just kind of sit around and are yes men. Flynn is as good as it gets, the guy that exposed Hillary and Obama basically running Al-Qaeda and ISIS, and the soft coup against them to not back Al-Qaeda and ISIS in the full takeover of the Middle East and many areas of Africa. And, of course, you heard that here 4.5 years ago. It's Cy Hirsch came on earlier this year to tip his hat and say, yes, you did basically break that, and this is all true, and it's happened. Just so, there you go. That's Cy Hirsch, Pulitzer Prize winner, concurring with our analysis. So we're going to have the former leader of the, I mean, what do you call it? The leader, the guy that actually ran the NSA, not the politician that sits on top of it, but the guy that headed the NSA is coming on. I mean, that's the type of guest we have, okay? I mean, this is trailblazing. And I'm not bragging. I just want listeners to know, we're not putting chopped liver out here. This is not BS. I mean, we're going to play exclusive Obama saying he hates America tomorrow and basically hates white people, okay? Like, I don't even want to wait till tomorrow. This is so dangerous. We should probably get him on today and release it, but just whatever. I don't usually get butterflies, but the world is quickening so fast. I've got them all the time now. Okay. So we've got all this unfolding, all this happening, and you've got her collapsing and the media covering it up and only showing her beginning the seizure. And you've got all of her anger issues the Secret Service has told us about on air. And all the other points you can add to this. And now you've got the Washington Post saying Clinton asked why she isn't beating Trump by 50 points. No, the headline should be Hillary appears to lose it for a few seconds, looks completely crazy, and then doesn't use proper English. And she does this sometimes. Why aren't I 50 points ahead? Why aren't I? So we're going to play that video right now. Obviously, it's not as powerful for radio listeners. TV viewers, Infowars.com/show. You'll be able to see it, but it's posted on Infowars.com. It's posted on DrudgeReport.com from the Washington Post. Everybody needs to look at this. But by itself, it's like, okay, big deal. But you add it in context to all the other weirdness. She's deteriorating quickly. Here's the clip.
And I will fight back against so-called right to work. Right to work is wrong for workers and wrong for America. Now, having said all this, why aren't I 50 points ahead, you might ask? Well, the choice for working families has never been clearer. I need your help to get Donald Trump's record out to everybody. Nobody should be fooled. He proudly declared himself 100% right to work. He even hired a union-busting firm to break up an organizing campaign at his hotel in Las Vegas, where you are right now. And he built up his wealth by stiffing small businesses and contractors. That goes against everything we stand for as a country. My dad was a small business. I'm just a businessman. I'm just happy he never did business with Trump.
Hillary's like a different person every time she speaks now. She's clearly drugged up. She clearly looks like a puppet. When you watch the video, she's deteriorating quickly. But we're going to add it together with a bunch of other videos in the next hour and put out something that really shows you a compilation of what's happening that makes it even clearer. But right now, as we go out to break, here's General Flynn talking about how dangerous she is last week.
If there was a temperament problem, for anybody who watched the Commander-in-Chief's town hall a week or so ago, now you saw the temperament rise up in Hillary Clinton. And you saw her when she stood up on the stage here to argue with the individual, the great, I believe the gentleman that asked the question was out of the Navy or a Navy veteran. Now, tough question. And she lost her temper. She lost her temper. And that's something that...
That's something he goes on to say we don't need as a commander-in-chief in control during serious crises with nuclear weapons. So when we come back, we're going to play the full clip for folks. And we also have other clips of her. And we're going to have the clip of the Navy veteran asking the question and more. All this and a ton of other key intel straight ahead today. And then inside the NSA, secrets that nobody else has ever revealed. Boy, I tell you, my head is just spinning, and sometimes I cross wires because I know Joel Gilbert's been working to release info from the Obama family in Kenya with us, and he's got some other stuff he's releasing tomorrow. Then I've got Paul working with others and people connected to the family with other video we have that we're going to be putting out soon, as soon as we're authorized to, Obama talking about how bad white people are and how much he hates America, basically. So all of those are going on. Gilbert's on a similar subject, but in another area tomorrow, and he has released information from the family before. So that's how I was mixing those two together, because the two articles came out basically together. So that's how much intel's pouring in here. It really becomes dizzying. Dizzying is a word for it. I mean, look at this. This has got no attention, and I've got hundreds of articles just as insane. Julian Assange says he'll turn himself in if Obama pardons Chelsea Manning, because Chelsea Manning was one of the main people that gave him these documents. WikiLeaks tweets, offers one day before a Swedish appeals court upholds warrant for Assange arrest. Then we've got this bizarreness we're going to play later. It's up on Infowars.com. Bizarre message plays on hacked radio station. Trump will go 26th, a Paul Watson article. So that's just some of the news on that front. The article that I was mixing together with Gilbert's info is leaked video shows Obama railing against white people during Kenya trip. So, again, that's coming soon. Oh, my gosh. It's amazing. Then, of course, we've got the whole situation in North Carolina and Charlotte. We've got an article that's very important. Media prepares for Hillary defeat. Now mainstream media is saying, hey, we better actually get ready to deal with this. The left is reportedly, even Politico reporting, panicking and saying, what's wrong with Hillary? Where is she? Now she's not doing any public events. She's not talking to press. She will basically show up and talk to people via satellite or Skype. And even then, she seems wooden. She seems angry. She seems robotic. And her eyes look completely insane. And I mean, we've always seen different Hillarys, but this is getting downright weird. Downright bizarre. Speaking of downright bizarre, Obama set to veto 9/11 victims' bid to sue the Saudis. 15 of the 19 hijackers came from there. We now know, and I knew back at the time, and had guests on like Mr. Springman, who headed up the embassy visa section, that they were ordered to let them in, saying, quote, they work for the CIA, even though they were listed as terrorists in the watch list. We're told we have to have all this new NSA spying, but then even when they're on the terror watch list, they're told, go ahead and let them in. Just like the reported attacker in New York and New Jersey that wasn't a bomber, wasn't a terrorist, but now admittedly was working for ISIS. Told his father he was going to attack. He told the FBI nothing was done. We have all the spying, and every time it's used to make sure the bad guys go free. It's used to make sure that, oh, we've discovered FBI agents, this is the Justice Department, 3 years ago, are investigating the San Bernardino shooters, who would later become the shooters. Let's put a criminal investigation on them for civil rights violations. The FBI was on the very people and was ordered to stand down. Think about that. Now, think about that. French news agency. President Barack Obama is poised to veto legislation exposing Saudi Arabia to court action over the 9/11 attacks, stepping in to defend legal precedent and an awkward ally, but inviting election time problems. White House officials say Obama will reject the Justice Against Sponsors of Terrorism Act by a Friday veto deadline after a little over a week of deliberation. And of course, what's in the 28 pages? That the Saudi royal house, that the king of Saudi Arabia was authorizing the 9/11 hijackers and the attack. And people say, well, there's a lot more to it than that, Alex. I know that. But if you can prove that the government stood down and the FBI was ordered to stand down before and after the attacks, and that NORAD was physically ordered to stand down, which we have from the former head of transportation, Norman Panetta, in five different interviews, we've interviewed him. Our reporters on the street got a quick response. He said, no, I was there with Dick Cheney. There was a stand down. That is sensational. The plane's 50 miles out. It's 30 miles out. It's 20 miles out. It's 10 miles out. Does the order still stand, sir? Of course your order still stands. You hear anything else? So both parties at the top have committed this massive crime. They thought the corruption would be so big that it would bind them all together. It's called the cement of blood. That's a Nazi term. That once they committed crimes together, that's known in criminology, that's known in gangs, that's known in warfare, that they would then stick together because they're all guilty. And so once the upper echelon of the government was involved in the cover-up, even after the fact, they could now be held accountable. And the word was, even major university professors came out and said, okay, yeah, it was a staged event, but we can't bring this out or it'll bring down the entire government and the whole system. And the greater good is, let the cover-up continue. No, the greater good is, let it all come down. Obviously, it's bigger than the Saudis. We know that. I'm the expert on 9/11, folks. I've interviewed hundreds of them. I brought it out before. 2 months before 9/11 happened, I said they're going to blow up the World Trade Centers, blame it on their asset, Bin Laden, who will be involved, but he'll take the fall. On and on and on. We told you the whole nine yards, okay? And when I say I am the world expert, when I say I am the founder of 9/11 Truth, it's a fact. It's undisputed. I'm not bragging. But I don't need a bunch of Johnny-come-latelys here in 2016 to tell me I'm covering up 9/11. I'm exposing it, but I'm not going to let the globalist blame the whole United States government or other governments for it when it was a criminal, multinational, corporate combine invading our government, using our system at key juncture points and flipping off key intelligence switches so the attacks could take place. I'm going after the traitors, the moles, the infiltrator. I'm not an idiot who lets the globalist stage this stuff, blame America worldwide, which they've let 9/11 Truth get out and do, but only to blame the U.S., and then turn around and bring a police state in on the heels of the terror threat. And again, you're like, oh, I've heard this before. Yeah, it's happening with the 5 million invaders called refugees in Europe right now. It's happening with the million plus. Believe me, it's a million plus. I mean, they're everywhere. It's tens of thousands in the public schools in Austin in the last 2 years alone. I mean, it's amazing. I've lived here since high school. My grandmother's from here. It's like I live in the Middle East now. So just like in Europe, they'd say it was 100,000 when it was a million. When it was a million, it was 5 million. Same metric, same system, same operation. And so global crime syndicates are orchestrating terror, protecting terror networks to then set up the police state, which they believe they will control when they totally overthrow our governments. They haven't totally overthrown European governments yet. The EU's trying. They haven't totally overthrown the U.S. government. They're trying. Now they stage a civil war. Now they stir up racial division. Now they have the very same people that funded the Arab Spring, the Wahhabist Sunni Spring. George Soros, billions in State Department money, billions in Soros money, billions to destabilize Ukraine, $5 billion. He bragged about it on TV, CNN. Samantha Powers bragged about it at a State Department briefing, UN briefing, joint briefing. This is not my opinion. They think you're so politically illiterate, so geopolitically blind, so culturally dim, which I know you're not. Especially the people that listen to the show. That's why military and governments listen. Where else do you hear real, frank discussions about the real world? You've got the unwashed, stupid, fake intellectual liberals that are into, you know, having socks that don't match. You know, that shows how smart they are and criticizing free speech. Let them sit over there in their squalor. They're victims of this wicked culture. Feel sorry for them, but move on from them. Don't worry about what they say or what they do or how they misrepresent. And so we have Obama protecting the Saudi royal house along with the Republican leadership. And you've got the Bushes knee-deep in 9/11 and the Saudis, along with the Clintons, defending Hillary and saying, we want Hillary in power. We're going to vote for Hillary because they want her to continue a rearguard action of their crimes. They need her to stay in power to cover for all of them. And that's how they've got the Republican and Democratic parties at the top merged together. And speaking of Hillary and her derangement, here's the larger clip of General Flynn last Friday introducing Donald Trump, bringing up the fact that Hillary looks like she's unstable and has serious problems. Here he is.
If there was a temperament problem, for anybody who watched the Commander-in-Chief's town hall a week or so ago, now you saw the temperament rise up in Hillary Clinton. And you saw her when she stood up on the stage there to argue with the individual, the great, I believe the gentleman that asked the question was out of the Navy or a Navy veteran. Now, tough question. And she lost her temper. She lost her temper. And that's something that I think we have to pay very close attention to. We cannot have that kind of judgment in the White House.
Then he introduces Trump. Now, we need to take that clip and edit it together with the Democratic Party ads implying that Obama, you know, is this wonderful savior, Hillary's the savior of stability, but that Trump's going to cause a nuclear war, but basically just reverse it and show the mushroom cloud going off with Hillary's eyes pointing different directions before she went off the campaign trail this week, with Hillary falling down, with Hillary blacking out, with Hillary wobbleheading, with Hillary, I came, I saw, he died, with Secret Service agents coming on this show, former Secret Service agents, and saying Hillary would knock Bill upside the head with a marble ashtray. Hillary would scream and yell at everybody and wouldn't give tips to people, and you couldn't look her in the eyes. I mean, she was a monster 20 years ago on a hussy power trip in there, you know, getting more tail than Bill Clinton, in his own words. She was in there, you know, just in a man's world dominating. I'll give it to her that. But now the old brain, the old blood vessels, the old brain tumor caught up with her. And they're so arrogant, they hope this corpse, this political corpse, can coast across the line to home base. Which shows how reckless these people are. I'm going to get into the situation next that's taking place in North Carolina, and our reporter that's flying out as we speak to cover it tonight, Joe Biggs, pray for him. But before I go any further, we've extended it because it was so popular and a lot of people asked us to extend it. So we are extending it. Super male and super female vitality. We've got all these estrogen mimickers and toxins in the food and the water. And we've got all of our hormones basically being suppressed. I don't know how all the ancient science works, but these are the known organic concentrated herbs, cold pressed. You don't find that anywhere else. Some people claim cold pressed, but they're doing it with dry herbs that they make wet again and then cold pressed. No, this is fresh herbs, then cold pressed. That's why it's so amazing. It's 20% off, and your purchase makes the broadcast possible. I want to thank you for your support. You've heard the rave reviews, and you can read more of the reviews, five-star reviews at Power Reviews and other respected sites that we link to. Dr. P in Connecticut says 43, five-star rating. But feeling 21, seemingly impossible results in minimal time, working 80, 90 hours a week, I was beginning to feel run down. 2 weeks after taking Super Male Vitality, and I feel the energy and enthusiasm that I have when I was 21. Yeah, Shane Steiner has great genetics, you know, went to high school with him, but then he just still working out at like, you know, 38 or so when I started hanging out with him again, you know, ran back into him at his family steakhouse and saw him. We started hanging out again since high school. Because he'd left for, you know, over a decade. His country music career was very successful, but he got out of it for family reasons. I'm going into a little diatribe about my high school friend, and he just said, oh, you supplements? Oh, yeah, look, Alex, you're out of shape. What are you doing? I said, hey, I'm just trying to get back in shape. I'm launching these. They work great. Take some. He made fun of me, came back a month later and said, I want a whole case for my family and bought it. And his dad's a big sports enthusiast, world champion bull rider, stuff like that. They all went crazy over it. And that's because they take a lot of supplements, and this really blew them away. And, you know, here I am, overweight, out of shape. Like, you got supplements, Alex? Is this a joke? You know? And he wasn't being mean to me. He's just like, you know, I've not been working out as hard as I should. I just don't feel like I'm into it anymore. And he came back and he said, it's the libido. This stuff is incredible. Anthony Gagliardi was there in the warehouse when he was making fun of me 3 years ago. Making fun of me. And now Shane is just in most insane shape at 43 years of age. And he all puts it to Super Male Vitality. Just the mental thing it clicked for him to want to work out longer and harder. And the libido you feel right away in my experience and many others. Lauren, a 5-star review. I love it. Got this because my friend raved about it. I love the energy and the focus it gives. I was a bit of a skeptic, but I am a true believer. It's great part of my day. Absolutely. And there are other enhancement supplements out there that do a pretty good job, but they all make me feel weird or too aggressive or break out, and this just hasn't done it. But try it for yourself. Consult your healthcare provider because it is a very, very serious supplement. Go see the 5-star reviews. There are 1,471 of them. It's got a 4.5-star review by Power Reviews and Review Snapshots. There's a bunch of other ones. Just go check it out for yourself. Unprecedented. Unprecedented. I want to thank you for your support. Anthroplex is dry herbs, but it's organic. And quite frankly, is a higher dose of some of the same stuff. Doesn't have everything Super Male does. Has some things it doesn't. I don't want to say it's a poor man's, but it's half as much because it costs a lot less to make because it's dry herb. Still excellent. Still as fresh as we can get them. Not sitting in a warehouse for a year, I can tell you that. So it's fresh, dry herb, which is what everything we sell should be, because then you can source it and actually get it. It's hard to get organic dry herb that was just recently dried and fresh. That's hard enough, and then have it pass all the tests. That's another issue, is we try to have everything be California standard, which almost nobody can pass. Most of our products, I think 90-something percent do. A few of them, sometimes a test comes back and something doesn't quite pass California, so we just put a, you know, insert with it when it goes to you that it doesn't pass California. And then when the next batch comes in and it does, then we don't have to put the insert in. But it's just a lot of hoops to jump through. This is serious stuff, and it supports the broadcast. Secret 12 is the strongest organic form of methylcobalamin that Dr. Gruber could come up with. Again, the supplement Nazi sites, and I don't mean literal Nazis, I mean Seinfeld style, the folks that really know what they're doing, and people that are obsessed with quality, give us the highest reviews out there. You can sign up for AutoShip and get 10% off additionally. Sign up again for AutoShip and get an additional 10% off. And we also have a lot of free shipping deals out there, like $50 or more, you get free shipping. I hardly ever seem to remember to plug that. There's just a lot of specials. 50% off on Make America Free Again, Made in America hats and other apparel. Those are about to sell out, so that's about to end. And your purchase makes the broadcast possible. And the new free InfoWars Live app with the audio, the video feed, special reports, and more has been number 30 overall on Apple alone and was the fifth most searched app yesterday. No, fourth most searched. And it also has a 5-star review, not just on Apple, but on the Droid systems as well. Well, Loretta Lynch, when you see her up on TV,
before the Beatles,
it's so bizarre, it's so weird to see the attorney general that openly meets illegally with Bill Clinton on a plane a week before the FBI director that works for her comes out and no bills, things that are admittedly crimes, to see her up there stirring up more trouble about the police shootings, which they're using to bring in UN control. Global control. She's on TV right now giving a press conference. We can put her up on screen. And she's acting like, because I was watching the ticker at the bottom, I was watching the closed captioning during the break, blaming the police when, if you look at what happened in Charlotte, North Carolina, a black cop shot a black man who had a gun in his hand, there's video of it, with it out on the concrete, saying, put the gun down. And he wouldn't turn loose of the gun. Cops are pointing guns at you, and you've got a gun in your hand, and they say, drop the gun. You know what you do? You drop the gun. And then now there's all this rioting and all this racist attacks on white people. And I even watching Fox News, they're like, is it racist? Are they protesters or are they looters? There's protesters, but there's a bunch of looters out there. And all these videos I've got of white people being attacked and being targeted doesn't make me go out and hate black people. It makes me hate George Soros and the globalists that for the last 8 years have been hyping this 24/7. And then we even get their emails that have come out in the last month from WikiLeaks and DC leaks with Soros coordinating the Muslims, the right wingers overthrowing Ukraine. He'll use any group he can. Ukraine 3 years ago started as an anti-police riot funded by George Soros. I mean, this guy really wants to overthrow the country. And of course, once it's overthrown, the black people will be blamed for what happened. Soros will ride off into the sunset. And I guess he's done it so many other countries, he thinks he can get away with it here. Meanwhile, Donald Trump comes out, the media gives him almost no credit and says the killing of Mr. Crutcher in Tulsa is very, very troubling, and the woman chokes and kills him when he's doing everything he's told. She needs to be fired. She needs to be charged with manslaughter. And because the police have to go after bad cops, even if she choked and didn't mean to kill him, don't make up a story. You got to get in trouble, lady. You got to get in trouble. You choked and killed a father of, what, 4 or 5 kids, no criminal record. You killed a good guy whose car was broken down. And most cops are great. I don't know how they do it, but, man, I've had the same type of crazy cops. You know, in my life, just be all jacked up and suddenly screaming at you, pointing a gun at you. And, you know, it's like, what's your problem? And usually they're looking for somebody or something else is going on. But the point is they're all fueled up on adrenaline. And then you think to yourself, well, how many times have I done dumb stuff when I'm fueled up on adrenaline? I mean, I get it. That's why I don't want that job. But you can't just go around and just execute somebody and then make up some story. Now, we'll see if more info comes out, but let's go out to break because I got a bunch of these clips. Let's go out to break with this clip. This is the Keith Lamont Scott's brother calls all white people devils. And so then it's okay to just randomly beat up white people that are even out there part of your cause. This is crazy. Here's the clip.
I know. Guys, is there anything we should know? No.
Want to add? Just know that all white people are f***ing devils.
And make sure you air that one.
Air that.
Don't take that.
All white cops are f***ing devils and white people.
And then a black cop reportedly shot his brother. I mean, I don't get this. And we got more of these clips. Black thugs beat white man in Charlotte. Let's fade down the music and go out to break with this. Here's the little pathetic white guy begging. Here it is. Now, the KKK was around. A black person beating him up would be wrong there, right? These folks are going to do that to the wrong person, I'm telling you. We'll be right back with the second hour. Stay with us. So you got Charlotte, North Carolina. And you've got a black cop shooting a black man, and there's video. It's on Infowars.com. That, you know, they've now released the footage, and he's got the gun out in his hand. They're saying drop it, and he won't do it. So the black cop, I don't care if I was a white cop or a purple cop or a green cop or a pink cop. I mean, I would shoot you if you got a gun and you're not letting it go. And I mean, and the police chief's black, but it doesn't matter. The brother, Keith Lamont Scott. Up there in Charlotte, his brother calls all white people devils. And I guess his girlfriend or wife, some lady with him, is sitting there agreeing. And I've got video after video of young black people mainly. That's encouraging because folks can be dumb when they're young and wake up later. I hope they wake up. All over Charlotte beating up white people. We've got Brentley Vinson, what we know about the Charlotte police officer, that a guy has a gun in his hand waving it around, and then they jump on top of him and he won't turn loose of it. I mean, what the hell do you do? But I guess he killed this guy because he hates black people, and I'm sure he hates his mother too. But let's go to the brother of the guy that got shot with all this craziness. Why aren't people rioting in Tulsa? I mean, I'm going to be honest. I'm not calling for rioting, but if it comes out this woman just executed this guy, which it looks like, and she doesn't get in some serious trouble, I might go up to Tulsa and do a little bit of rioting. I mean, you know, I'm not, I mean, but every time the people don't ever protest an illegitimate shooting, because there's not that many of them, they protest, you know, the brown up in Missouri, or the situation with Trayvon Martin with like seven black witnesses that he was assaulting Zimmerman. I think Zimmerman's a weirdo. I said that. It's come out he's a weirdo. I'm not saying he's perfect. But the point is this the number one thing in the country? It's to stir up racism. It's like up there, you know, in Maryland, where, you know, they kill the black guy in the back of the paddy wagon. It turns out most of the cops are black. They still made that about white people. Then the statistics come out that white cops and cops in general actually don't want to respond to these areas and are actually least likely to kill a black person because they're scared of losing their job. Kill a white person or Hispanic is kind of like, oh, that's all right, because there's not this big lobby to freak out. And it's all projection from the fact that I kept saying over 1,000 people. That number was a few months old. I'm sorry. It's over 2,000 people so far shot in Chicago this year, almost all of them black. And the death toll is just astronomical. That's what's approaching 1,000. I mean, this is crazy. But, you know, 100-something people shot illegitimately a year. 30, 40, 50 maybe are black people. And it's you'd think it's the end of the world. So, I'm sorry. I have a problem with numbers. I have a problem with facts. And I'm someone that's had cops repeatedly pull guns on me for no reason. But I'm not out to get them. Maybe the guy had too many Starbucks coffees, but I mean, I got pulled over once. My weight belt back when I was in high school was sitting there in the front seat. He pulls over. Hey, you know you're speeding? Oh, boom, get out of the car. You know, he had that gun right to my head in seconds. And I was just like, it's a weight belt. And he goes, okay, you can go. Sorry. Now, if he'd have pulled me out and took me to jail because his adrenaline was going and be mad at me that he jumped the gun and almost blew my head off, then I'd say that guy was a horrible person. The truth is, he's got instinctive training. He walks up, all right, license, registration, boom! You know, he got a gun to my head because the window's down, boom! Because there's that weight belt, looks like a holster. Is that a gun? Is that a knife? What is it? It's a weight belt. What's in the bag? What's in the bag? Frozen yogurt. But even if he'd have jumped the gun and blown my head off then, you could have said, well, he shouldn't have done it. He thought it was a gun. Oh, it's terrible. You know, he needs to get off the force, whatever, pay my family. But no, in the case of what happened in Tulsa, it's even worse. I didn't get to the clips. I'm going to play the clips coming up. But William Binney is going to be joining us, former leader of the National Security Agency, and a lot more. Talking about the new movie Snowden. We also have a former NSA whistleblower as well. Wayne Madsen is an Infowars.com reporter joining us. Stay with us. We'll be back. Well, there is a composite character based on Mr. Binney, played by Nicolas Cage in the new film, Snowden. And I wanted to get Mr. Binney, the former leader of the National Security Agency, on to get his view on the film and to discuss how accurate it is. From my research, it's extremely accurate on many, many fronts. I just want to say this is Oliver Stone's best work in my view. But I saw some areas in the film that even though I'd read books about Snowden and obviously read thousands of articles about it, I really wasn't aware of. And when I say I wasn't aware of it, I knew all about it from other whistleblowers and my own research and the fact that pieces of it had come out over the years, like the Stuxnet and other systems, that industrial hardware had been loaded into the software, the chips themselves, in layman terms, into telecommunications and power grids around the world, including in our allies like Japan, Switzerland, Germany, you name it. Because from the engineers I talked to, going back two decades, they were always explaining to me, Alex, keyword searches, basically a Google for the private internet, a Google for digital communication, a searchable system is the basis of Echelon and what's going on. And of course, we have the top expert in the world, undisputed. So I'm just giving you a basic layman gestalt here. He'll correct any fallacies or any misrepresentations. But from studying this 20 years, I mean, I've been on the cutting edge of having whistleblowers on and trying to understand it, that the big enchilada was the plan to load kill switches and things into key infrastructures around the world, because the concern is enemies or traitors or terrorists or corporate extortion groups could get in and use those kill switches and control systems to wreak incredible havoc And shouldn't there be conventions against this type of warfare, just like there are against chemical, biological, or nuclear, so that we try to not ever have it take place? It just seems like building all these back doors into things and putting kill switches in things creates a vulnerability for everybody. And look at how Hillary is being stung by these surveillance grids. Look how George Soros is. Look how Obama is. Look at how all these crimes are coming out about the Bushes and the Saudis and the Clintons and all the rest of it. Through this surveillance grid they built, ignoring William Binney, who is admittedly the guy that built everything up to the late 1990s and 2001, but had it designed to actually defeat the Soviet Union, had it actually designed to roll up real terrorists with targeted information. Instead, they created a system where no one's safe, no one has their data protected, and it's showing the arrogance of these elites that weren't 200 IQ geniuses like Mr. Binney is. I mean, he's admittedly, even in mainstream news, and the government says, one of the most famous codebreakers ever. His thinking on computers and systems and breaking codes and algorithms is just second to none. He's an idiot savant when it comes to it, if he doesn't mind me saying that. That's why he ran the actual NSA, not the Politico that would go talk to Congress. And he tried to stop all this. We live in a world, then we're going to our guest for the rest of the hour. We live in a world where we have the supposed bomber in New York and in New Jersey. His father, 2 years ago, comes to the FBI and says he's planning attacks. They do nothing because they're ordered not to. And they had all this intelligence and data that he went to these foreign countries and did nothing. Same thing with the San Bernardino shooters, Major Hassan at Fort Hood, on and on and on. Oh, Obama didn't see the ISIS and Al-Qaeda invasions. Bull. So the truth is, we have this giant grid, and we're less safe. And that's what William Binney went through channels, resigned after he found out about all the spying in 2001. He's been a frequent guest here. And I'm just recapping it for new viewers and listeners, why this is so important. And then he went and testified to Congress in secret, and their response was to arrest William Drake, his colleague. Their response was to SWAT team him when he was in the shower on purpose. William Binney, the answer was to persecute the very patriots, you know, that held the position of multi-star generals in the command of this country, actually fighting real enemies. They just ignored them, pushed them aside, and engaged in this great act of treason. And then you're watching the film. This is real stuff that happened. You've got Snowden's boss at the CIA, when he's the top contractor at Booz Allen, telling him, don't worry about your girlfriend cheating on you. I went and checked on it. She's not cheating on you with that photographer. And just the realization, the last straw for Snowden, that this guy's watching the lady he's about to marry. And of course, it's all come out that most of these NSA people were, you know, out there doing stuff like this or watching people on webcams have sex. And I mean, it's just incredible and so powerful. He may disagree. He's the real expert. I'm going to skip this network break so we have more time. William Binney, thank you so much for your courage and coming back on. AGoodAmerican.org is the documentary film coming out that you're in. ExposedFacts.org. Bill Binney, thank you so much, sir.
Well, thanks for having me again, Alex. It's good to be with you.
In general, is what I said earlier, a basically accurate kickoff?
Actually, it's really spot on. I would only add that, the recent exposure of some of the software that was, I think they have another Snowden in the NSA somewhere, in the tailored access office, because all their software going at weaknesses against the firewalls, switches, servers, and the networks was captured and is now out in the open.
Wow.
And people are trying to sell it. So what that really I've been complaining about, because it's been very short-sighted of NSA and FBI to do this, not only did they create the weaknesses, but they also found weaknesses in the systems, like called zero-day weaknesses, built into the software companies were selling, and they never told anybody because that would be cybersecurity if they did that. I mean, that would protect people, would fix those, and they wouldn't be they couldn't be penetrated by those weaknesses then. So what they did was they allowed them to continue, and they did that simply because it allowed them a window to look into everything that everybody's doing. And for them, that was the operations side. They wanted to be able to do that so they could gather data on everybody. But what it meant was they left everybody vulnerable and exposed. And that's why you're seeing all these hacks today. It was very short-sighted of them.
And you warned them. You resigned over this. I mean, let's go over some of that. This is 16 years ago, 15 years ago.
Yes. I mean, first of all, the point you were like is what it called word.
Mr. Benny, I think you're on a cell phone. We might try to get a landline with you. I didn't know we were on cell. Can you get to a different position for a second, please?
Okay. Let me see if I can move. Okay.
Oh, you're a lot better. Please
can
continue.
You hear me a little better?
Yeah, sir. Go ahead.
Okay. Well, I meant the dictionary select approach or word search is like a Google search has been the foundation of how they operated since the Telex days, which is the 1930s. And they took it through the courts, and all the courts agreed they could do that. And so that's why they've continued doing that instead of trying to think of a better way to do it, especially in the digital age when they're buried with all kinds of data. So, that's what's making them dysfunctional, because when you do those word searches, you get so much material you can't get through it. That's one of the founding problems that they have and why they're failing to stop all these attacks, even when they know all the people who commit them.
That's amazing. So they leave all the vulnerabilities in the internet and telecommunications so they can break in easier in an automated way, knowing full well it leaves our government, our industries, our people open to hackers, open to other governments, and they call that cybersecurity. I call that the opposite.
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
Wow.
That's very short-sighted.
Well, when you told him this more than 15 years ago, again, former leader of the NSA, William Benny, what did they say to you?
They didn't say anything. They just they ignored me. They I couldn't get them to do anything I was suggesting. It was just, after Hayden came in, they adopted the collect everything approach or bulk acquisition approach. Why? It was a hopeless case. They wouldn't. They simply wouldn't listen. In the case of Tom Drake, when he went up to talk to the general counsel of NSA, they told him, don't ask any more questions. So, I mean, that was their answer.
You know, watching the film Snowden, I want to talk about that a little bit with you, sir, but then get into any area you want. You're obviously the expert. You're one of the few people that's actually in the same boat as Snowden in that, in the film and also in speeches he's given, he points out that he would write software to do something constitutional that actually helped us, they would always twist it to do something unconstitutional or basically evil. And then, of course, a lot of the things you developed, we now know were actually twisted into what's currently going on, Dr. Benny.
Yeah, that's right. And actually, I was an advisor to Oliver Stone on the movie. So I tried to make sure that all the information he had was accurate and
so no, I should have pointed that out, obviously. So that's why it's so incredibly accurate, is that the former head of the NSA basically was the technical director. So tell us about the film and what you think of it.
Oh, I think the film is absolutely great. It's a great film. I mean, what it does is it takes you through someone, Edward Snowden, who starts off being a very positive supporter of the government and what it's doing, and then takes you through his life and how it experiences and how in the end, he starts to see the corruption and the crime, the criminality of it, and then he turns, and that's really what this is all about. That story of his experiences going through his work with CIA and NSA.
I remember.
And I think it really shows.
I was raised a Democrat.
See, I didn't know your story, but I think
it gives you a window into what's really happening, even though people don't realize that's what's going on.
Take some time then as the technical advisor on the film to break down what's really happening and what's really going on. And then I'd like to ask you specifically about what I mentioned earlier, an area you never see on the news, but that is covered in the film and that I haven't really heard you elaborate too much on this show. Please take some time out on loading the software and the hardware, the chips, into all of our allies' infrastructure and our own telecoms and our own computer companies working with the NSA, CIA, and others, and private contractors to load the whole world with these holes, which, again, the hackers all then learn about and exploit. I mean, it's our government basically ruining the internet for the world and letting bad hackers do whatever they want, not just our own government.
Yeah, I mean, the point is that NSA and the U.S. government have no monopoly on smart people. So that means any weakness they create in the system can be detected by others around the world. It's not just governments, but it can be individual hackers. I mean, it's not something that is a smart thing to do. If you find problems, you should fix them so that people are a little more secure. So, but that's the real problem. But for example, they would do things. There's three ways they go at the worldwide network. One is working with the communications companies that own the fiber lines that allow them to tap them in cooperation with them. They help them do that. And then the other is to go with governments and have the governments get involved, the intelligence agencies of, for example, the BND or GCHQ. Other intelligence agencies get in and cooperate with them in terms of tapping fibers and acquiring data. And the third one is it's a unilateral thing. If nobody gets the agreement from the governments or from the companies, they simply do it unilaterally, covertly, you know, like that would be the muscular taps of the fiber lines between the data centers of Yahoo, Google, and all the major internet service providers. So they could tap all of those lines with or without their approval or help. And so it simply means that they're after all the data in the world. The problem here is they all are so confused, and I give them the benefit of the doubt. So I say they're all confused in terms of saying and thinking that data is intelligence. Data is not intelligence. It's simply data. You have to analyze that and be able to figure out what is meaning in that and data to be able to produce intelligence.
Yeah, just because you have a warehouse of books or a library doesn't mean you've read all those books.
Exactly, and you don't really know what the essence is of those books until you can understand them and be able to put a picture together and infer things like intentions and capabilities and threats.
Wow. What about the particular areas where we see them shutting down the power grid and internet grid of Syria, which we now know did happen, and Snowden seeing that unfold? What about when we see the model of being able to, again, shut off the power of all of Tokyo or all of Japan? I mean, we're not just talking about putting grids in to spy on the data. The film gets into the kill switches, the systems they can use to actually shut down the power grid.
Yeah, I think in the 30C3 conference, the Computer Chaos Club conference in Hamburg, Germany, 2 years ago, I think Jacob Applebaum went through a whole series of programs they had from close-in access to actually implanting hardware and software in switches as they were transiting, like Cisco switches that were being shipped through the mail. They would waylay the shipment, open up the packages, insert the hardware and software to allow them to take over the switch anytime they wanted, and then close it back up and let it continue on. And then the poor sucker at the other end installs it in their system, and they own their switch and their system.
And I've been told by whistleblowers inside the biggest carriers that it's industrial scale, that we're not just talking about, say, in a city like Austin, you think you're going to go call the mall, go into a particular store and buy a product, but they've got a lot of people in those that actually work as a side job as a, quote, Homeland Security Infrastructure Protection Officer, and they sit there with the data package and say, oh, your package will be ready in a few days, and then they jack it with all the crap, and you come and pick it up. I mean, this is industrial-level espionage just against humanity.
Right, it's the whole world. Also, I would point out that's basically what the FBI and NSA were after with the iPhone and Apple. The idea that they wanted Apple to allow, they had more than 10, they would delete everything on the phone.
Sorry, your phone cut out again there. We know we can't use your landline because of tapping. I wasn't supposed to get into that, I know, but let's go back to your cell here and repeat what you just said, Mr. Benny. Yeah, this is Key Intel on Apple. I know they don't want this out, but let's go ahead and try to move to another position. We'll get this out.
Okay.
They've been jamming his phone line, folks. We've got to go to a cell phone. This is a little inside baseball, but go ahead.
How's now?
Yes, we can hear you now, sir. Go ahead.
Okay, well, I mean, with Apple and the iPhone, what they were really after was Apple to get software to disable that password limitation in terms of testing, and also the fact that they couldn't do, they had only you put like one in a minute, and also you needed to put in the character spacing, which meant that somebody was tapping it in, not a machine. So they wanted them to design software to get around that, and the reason they wanted to do that was because they already had stolen all of the user ID access codes from the SIM cards being produced by in the order of billions every year from companies. And so they had all these ID SIM card equivalences. So if these SIM cards were installed in any iPhone in the world, that once they signed on, they could access it remotely from NSA to any point in the world.
So they want the ultimate backdoor hardwired into everything. And to Apple's credit, they were one of the only companies not doing that, correct?
That's right. Yep. And that's good that they fought them, because this is, you know, this is actually NSA, I think, already had the ability to do that. And the FBI wanted to do it so they could claim that that would be the how they access the data and be admissible in court.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead. Sorry.
Well, there's so many questions. I'm jumping around here because it's just mystifying how powerful the film is. And I know that you were a consultant on it, because we'd interviewed about that a few years ago. And then it clicked. Of course, you were the technical advisor, so that's why it's so incredibly accurate. But looking at this now, where we are today, projecting forward, the film breaks down the fact that it's gotten worse under Obama, not better. And it seems like they're just moving forward. Where does this end?
Well, unless we stand up and do something about it, it's going to get even worse with the Internet of Things, you know? That's only going to get worse. So that means all the devices that you have and own are going to be connected to the Internet. That's going to make it exceedingly bad.
So now
they're all accessible and controllable.
All accessible and controllable, absolutely. The driverless cars, the smart meters, everything wired in. So it's not just this technocracy jacking into governments and power grids. Now it's your house.
That's right. And everything in it that's electronic, that's running.
Were you ever given
pacemakers and things like that, you know, if you want.
Oh, it's just unlimited what they can do with it. What about a larger plan? I mean, I know it's about looting and making money, hundreds of billions of dollars, you know, globally a year by these companies. But what's the master strategy on building this technocracy? I mean, do they have one?
I think it's this is my impression, okay? Certainly it is population control, but not just of any given country, but of the world. And so what they're after in direct, and I think Obama has stated this from various points, that he wanted a world community. So I think that's probably what they're after. In order to do that, they have to be able to control the people of the world. So in order to do that, you have to have knowledge of them to know who's doing what, so you can stop it or manipulate it any way you want.
William Binney, that is the most profound thing I think I've ever heard you say, and you've said a lot of profound things. This is the key for a technocracy world government program, and Davos admits that's their plan, but here you are, the former leader of the National Security Agency, telling us that that's what they're building, a beast system. If you're not a Christian, it almost makes you one, doesn't it? William Binney's our guest. ExposedFacts.org publishes some of his writings. And he's also in the new documentary, AGoodAmerican.org. Stay with us, sir. We're going to go back to William Binney here in just a moment. He's with us for the balance of the hour. We really are thankful for his time. He's going to tell you in a moment when the new documentary that he's in and also an advisor on, A Good American, is coming out, AGoodAmerican.org. But again, Snowden, I just couldn't believe how accurate it was that Hollywood, as corrupt as it is, that this came out. You know, it gave me hope. We're going to be talking to him here in just a moment. Wayne Madsen's going to be popping in, investigative journalist, formerly with the National Security Agency as well. He's popping in with a few questions the next 30 minutes, but he'll ride shotgun with us for 30 minutes into the next hour as well. And then I'll open the phones up. And then Anthony Gucciardi is coming up. We've got Joe Biggs in the air going to North Carolina to Charlotte, where George Soros, admittedly, and the globalists are spending hundreds of millions of dollars trying to start a civil war to distract from the ongoing global colonization of the United States and everybody else that's taking place. I can't believe I'm saying this. It sounds like a science fiction movie, but it's in the emails. And we'll talk more about, with William Binney, what he warned of 15 years ago to the government. is biting them in the ass. And I'm sorry to use that term, but that's what's happening, where they build all these back doors to screw us, and then everybody's getting in, and it's bringing them down. It almost makes me want Big Brother, but I actually don't. But it's destroying them. And he's the first guy months ago that said he thinks it's somebody inside the government because the way it's coming out. And this is a guy that used to, you know, be able to track the Russians and predict and find people. He's really smart. But then I started talking to government sources, and people started getting executed and killed and arrested, and they said, no, this is the U.S. government. This is the U.S. Army. It's people inside different political organizations. Democrats are seeing all this evil. They know how bad Hillary is. And so they're trying to say the Russians are doing all this, and we're these traitors. Anybody that exposes, you know, what's happening with the NSA, when they're the ones that have sold us out. So they're being hoisted on their own petard, as they say. But before we go any further, we're listener supported with our great sponsors. One of them that we've had for, I don't know, 16, 17 years, Solutions from Science, always advertises once they have a sale going. Solutions from Science Solar Summer Sale is about to end because fall just started, but it's been extended just a few weeks. SummerSolarSale.com or call 1-877-327-0365. Amazing solar panel systems, control systems, really a bargain. Solutions from Science is one of my oldest sponsors and have been around forever. Right now they're having a solar summer sale, and they have many different options to choose from, including solar generations, solar generators, wind turbines, EMP bags, that's to not be tracked, smart LED light bulbs, and much more. Buy one perfect power package and use the coupon Alex to receive another one absolutely free. SummerSolarSale.com or call 1-877-327-0365 or SolarSale.com. That's SummerSolarSale.com. So a lot to cover, obviously. We're running some specials that are going to end very soon that we've extended on some of the nutraceuticals and supplements like Super Male and Super Female Vitality. We also have 20% off on high-quality organic vitamin B12 with our own proprietary brand, Secret 12. It's organic, vegan, highly absorbable. You take it under the tongue in several drops a day. This is what I give myself, my children. And the great part about it is these are high-quality products with five-star review on third-party sites, reviewed by thousands. And it's what I personally use, and it supports the broadcast and getting the word out. So it's so incredibly important. Now, going back to William Binney. Mr. Binney, I've been asking a lot of the questions here today, but I'd like to give you a few minutes to talk about other areas, other topics that are coming out dealing with the NSA, with all these other agencies, with the 800,000 contractors that have top secret access. I mean, this just sounds like a recipe for disaster. Other points you'd like to relay as the former leader of the National Security Agency to our viewers and listeners?
Well, I guess what I could basically say is that the real threat here is that intelligence is being outsourced to contractors. All types, I mean, including analysis, I mean, and translation, as well as hardware, software, and maintenance of your entire infrastructure of the intelligence community. So, it's pretty much morphing into a commercial operation. This is not good. I mean, you know, commercial companies have a different objective than government organizations. The government has at least a charter to do good things for the country, whereas corporations, their interest and focus is getting contracts and making money and profits. So the two, and it's very clear, for example, in the film that is about me, that's coming out in February of next year, it's called A Good American, it's very clear in that movie that you'll see how these corporations are manipulating the entire intelligence community and how they're actually doing harm to intelligence production. In fact, what I've been saying publicly for some number of years is what they've done is they've traded the security of the people of the United States and people of the world for money. And they did that by outsourcing to corporations and letting the corporations really govern how they operate and what they do. And this is not good for any country.
Simply put, it sounds like they would only want to make the world worse and have more threats so they could get more funding. And really, it's our government being taken over by multinational corporations. We're being conquered by the multinationals while they claim that the Russians are going to hack our election. So the UN and the EU and the OECD are coming in to, quote, monitor our elections. What does that sound to you like, Mr. Benny?
Well, it sounds like another step towards a world government, you know, a world organization. So, I mean, you know, it's just more of the same. It's just extending in a different facet. It's expanding in different aspects of life.
Yeah, the OSCE is the paramilitary intelligence arm of the OECD, and that's the private corporation that took over Europe after World War II and the Marshall Plan. That is the root of the EU and the global government. Again, the former head of the NSA, the actual leader of it, who helped bring down the Soviet Union, was, you know, privately awarded the highest awards you can get. I mean, can't get into those. Is here telling us that America is being taken over by a global government. And Obama, 2 days ago, I want to play a short clip, sir, was at the UN, and he said, look, we got to give up some of our sovereignty to be part of this global thing. Well, it's not like we're giving up sovereignty to be with other countries. We're giving up sovereignty to this mega corporate system that wants a carbon tax, that has given itself diplomatic immunity, tax immunity. This is the new royalty. And here is our president saying we should sign over to this. We should submit to the TPP and the rest of it. It is outrageous. Here it is.
But we have to put our money where our mouths are. And we can only realize the promise of this institution's founding to replace the ravages of war with cooperation if powerful nations like my own accept constraints. Sometimes I'm criticized in my own country for professing a belief in international norms and multilateral institutions, but I am convinced that in the long run, giving up some freedom of action, not giving up our ability to protect ourselves or pursue our core interests, but binding ourselves to international rules over the long term enhances our security. And I think
so. They have big global multinational corporations that have secret trade deals that cede our authority, and they admit that. And then he says to be safe and to be happy, we do that, we sign on to it. This is how we're being conquered. The 21st century, it's corporate, it's not military. And then as the film shows, and as they admit, most of the spying on the American people has nothing to do with stopping jihadis. And then Obama's been caught funding the jihadis as a Saudi Arabian proxy army. William Benny, hearing that clip, he went on to say we need a liberal world order, a liberal world government, exactly what you got into. I haven't heard you talk about world government being the objective, but I mean, it clearly is. Can you elaborate with your geopolitical and geospatial and technical understanding?
Yeah, well, I see, that's the problem, that technology has made this all possible. I mean, I've heard recently some people in Congress saying, you know, following all these people traveling around the world is just too difficult. We need more people. No, you don't. That's a trivial issue. I mean, we could easily follow 12 to 20 billion phone calls a day. If it's, you know, like 10 million people moving around every day is trivial. That's a trivial issue. So all of that could be done by technology. And yet they're claiming something is really difficult when in fact it's not. And so they're actually basically hiding the facts of what they're really doing by saying those things. And of course, they make it more difficult for anybody to. But it's a way of getting more money, more support, and squeezing the populace, basically swindling them out of money and resources. So that's really what the whole objective is.
Well, we have shot a lot of special reports with you when you've come and visited us here in Austin. We're going to retweet some of those today and repost some of those on Infowars.com. But undoubtedly, we're now in this paradox where they denied all this existed before, back when it was being done more constitutionally. And now that it's beyond 1984, I mean, just exponentially beyond it, I'd say billions of times beyond it, literally, when it comes to the amount of data being collected, that they just throw it in our face that we should just accept it. I mean, it is positive that this film is out. It's one of the top films of the country. It's causing a debate, but are you an optimist or a pessimist? I think I'm an optimist if we expose to people that we're being conquered by a multinational technocracy in their own words. If we don't define it as the fact we're being taken over and just fight their, you know, fake paradigm of, oh, you know, spy on us to keep us safe or not, I think we can beat this if we shatter the whole paradigm. But I think if we just argue about Big Brother, we're going to lose. What do you think, sir?
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, the sunshine is what they're really afraid of. Exposing what they're really doing and who's involved is really what they're afraid of. And that's why I keep trying to say these things publicly. My point, when I was on USA Today on TV shortly after Snowden material first started coming out, they asked me what I thought should happen with Edward Snowden. I said I thought he should be indicted, but that the law should be applied equally and in chronological sequence of the crimes. So we need to start first with Bush, Cheney, Hayden, and Tenet, all the people in their organization, the White House and the Department of Justice, NSA, CIA, and FBI were participating in this violation of really treason against the founding principles of this nation and violations of the law, pen register law, electronic privacy, electronic security act, and also all the FCC regulations governing the telecoms. They violated all of that. And that, so after that, that's where we should start with the criminal prosecutions. Then we should move to the Obama administration, do the same people, and then we do Snowden, you know. And since then, not too many people ask me what should happen to Snowden.
All right, I want to bring Wayne Madsen in for the rest of the hour to ask you some questions. He was formerly, obviously, with the NSA, but his main job was internal security and finding leaks, which I tie into your fact of building all these back doors is what created the leaks. So I want him to ask some of his questions, so it's not just an average lay researcher asking him. William Benny, former leader of the National Security Agency, is our guest. But there was an article came out on September 17th, and I found it ironic that the Washington Post was with The Guardian, given this info. It's been well known to be CIA since it was, basically set up in the 1940s, since it was taken over by the Grahams. Now it's run by Bezos and, the folks at Amazon, the Democratic Party. But to have them make money off the Snowden story, take the data and report on it, then they misrepresent what Snowden did, said he released classified information that hurt people when he didn't, he exposed the crimes. But to take the info, publish it, and still call for no pardon and for him to be basically put in prison or executed, I find to be the height of hypocrisy and arrogance. What do you make of the Washington Post saying no pardon for Edward Snowden, which obviously the movie Snowden pushes for?
Well, I've been trying to point out the government is violation of their own regulations. For example, Executive Order 3526. Is the executive order classification of all material in the U.S. government. Section 1.7 of that says that you cannot classify, maintain classified, or not declassify information that's evidence of a crime, corruption, fraud, waste, abuse, or embarrassment of a person or an agency. I mean, and it says several other things, but those are the core ones. And that says that they're in violation of their own regulations. So, I mean, it's like they're all saying they're playing the game of the Wizard of Oz. Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. Only look at this person over here. They're the bad guy.
Very well said. And I think that Snowden, to a great extent, is a toto in this whole thing. But so is yourself and Wayne Madsen and others. And it's not that I'd even call you heroes, even though in a world of cowards, you are a superhero. It's just that we have so many people that are just willing to go along with this and deny it's even happening, and people like you are shattering that paradigm and forcing them to face the man behind the curtain. I want to bring in Wayne Madsen and WayneMadsenReports.com. He'll be talking about this again after you leave in about 15 minutes. But you're on the air with William Benny. What are your questions or comments for this gentleman, Wayne?
Well, first, hi, Bill, and congratulations on the film. I look forward to seeing
Wayne.
It. And Alex, I think one of the most grotesque things about the Washington Post calling for no pardon for Snowden and effectively calling for his arrest, prosecution, and imprisonment is the fact that it's a violation of one of the arch canons of journalism. They called for the arrest and imprisonment of one of their own sources.
Exactly.
And that they got a Pulitzer Prize, which they shared with The Guardian because of that story. So on the one hand, they bask in the respectability of receiving a Pulitzer Prize. At the same time, they're calling for maximum punishment of one of their
sources. And let's be clear, this is the paper. This is the editorial board. This is not some one of their other writers. These are the most dishonorable, snot-nosed people I've ever seen in my life. Mr. Benny, you have a comment on this level of disgraceful activity?
Yeah, I think the reason they did all the took advantage of what Snowden had provided originally was because of Bart Gellman. He had the integrity and guts to go into that and make sure it got published. So, I mean, otherwise, you know, otherwise, many of us look at it as the Washington compost.
Some say it's the worst publication in the country. Wayne, we're about to go to break, but other questions. You're talking to William Benny. What have I not been asking?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think it's what you hit this thing with Obama's speech to the UN, and it's quite clear when you look. And Bill, you don't have to go into the details, but when I look at those Snowden slides and I see all the foreign affairs directorate relationships between the NSA and, good God, and maybe 60 or some countries around the world, some of which are not known to be close allies of the United States. You just wonder what the end game is here. Is it to place the world under some sort of a global surveillance network, regardless of how it helps or hurts U.S. national security?
Let's come back and talk about this global surveillance directorate, because we've hit on it here. This isn't the NSA. This is a corporate global takeover. People in the NSA like William Benny and others have been fighting it. They are heroes. We'll be back with William Benny to respond to this. On the other side, I'm Alex Jones. Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com are our sites. The new app launched 2 days ago. It's already in the top 30 on the big Apple site and is the fourth most searched app. It's All right, we have William Benny, former leader of the National Security Agency, with us for 5 minutes the next hour. Then Wayne Madsen rides shotgun for two more segments to get into politics and other developments in the news. But if you just tuned in, William Benny, patriot, one of the top code breakers in U.S. history, created much of the software and the infrastructure that won the Cold War. That's on record. This guy was a hero before he went to Congress and said, you're building back doors into everything. It makes the entire internet and everything open to hackers. It's spying on everybody's webcam. Stop it. And they said, nope. He resigned. Then they SWAT team him. They start arresting people. I mean, this is serious business. And they're committing these crimes. They're getting away with it, but not forever. And you were getting into world government again, whether it was intentional or not. And they now admit it's intentional. They've transferred data, they've transferred a global system of surveillance that corporations, that just a few Fortune 100, control. This is a corporate world government, and you were just speaking to it, Wayne Madsen brought it up. This is basically, in my view, a foreign multinational takeover. This is a 21st century attack. You know, we're wondering what wars would look like in the future. This is an information war. And they've taken over. They admit the stock market's rigged. The currency markets are rigged. They admit the interest rates are rigged. I mean, everything's rigged now by J.P. Morgan and Goldman Sachs, and they're the ones at the heart of these multinational agreements. Can you elaborate on that? And what do we do to unseat them, to illustrate this to people, sir?
Well, from my point of view, I mean, if the British company is becoming like the some of them are becoming things like the sixth military industrial intelligence contractors in the U.S. if you look at, like Wayne had pointed out, all of the first, second, and third party agreements with between countries, that doesn't count fourth parties that aren't even listed. So it's like those who we don't want to recognize we have a relationship with at all, which goes far beyond those already exposed by Snowden. So if you look at all of that, it's really saying you're using all of this intelligence you're gathering to gain influence and access and control and also acceptance of by other countries around the world. So they're all trying to join this club of having all this knowledge about everybody. The main parties are, of course, the Five Eyes. The main English speaking is the U.S., U.K., Canada, Australia, New Zealand. But also a number of other European countries are participating right now, up to seven or eight of them, I think, in this internet stuff. But also others are trying to get into that.
That's another question. What do you make? You know, we hear we're, quote, handing over the DNS and control of the internet to, quote, the world. But really, it's the same group of corporations and the UN that we were just talking about. So, again, the coup is ongoing.
Yeah, I don't see it's all like a what you want to, if you could refer to it as a self-licking ice cream cone, you know, It's all serving itself. And it's just keeping, it keeps growing and growing and growing. The only thing we could do is try to expose it and try to get people to get to understand that this is not really good for anybody. And we need to all stand up and resist this. And if people in that we elect in Washington or any other governments don't want to stop this, I mean, we should insist and fire them all. And hire people who will stop it.
Absolutely. And vote with our dollars. Don't support self-driving cars. Yeah. The globalists say they're getting rid of us in cars. It's a total technocracy takeover. Wayne, we're going to break. He's with us 5 more minutes. Ask the question now. We'll come back and hear the answer in the next segment. Another one of your interesting questions for Mr. Benny.
Well, I would ask Bill on the fourth party agreements. When I see a country like Brazil listed, I wonder how much of that information was used to bring down their own president, Rousseff, in a constitutional coup?
That's a great question. Let's talk about destabilization efforts using these systems in 70 seconds. We'll be back with William Benny. Stay with us. And the empire we face is a private, corporate, anti-free market empire. It runs the leftist, you name it. It admits, I mean, their white papers are public. They're very arrogant that they're establishing a technocracy. They call their form of government global technocracy in the technotronic era. That's Zbigniew Brzezinski. He wrote that book in 1974. They've done it. They're like 90% of the way there. And you have one of the top brains in the world, William Benny, giving you his analysis of a private, corporate, global, technotronic-based system. He's going to leave us here in about 4 minutes. I'm very thankful for his time, his courage, what he's gone through. I have to pinch myself that I'm not dreaming here because I'm so honored to be with this crew and people like Wayne Madsen, people like William Benny, who are filled with integrity. And this is the stuff that made America great, people like William Benny. You heard his question about fourth parties, Brazil, people signing on for destabilization campaigns, internal coups, shining deals with the globalist to then get the data to be able to carry out coups in their country. Can you speak to that, Mr. Benny?
Well, I think Wayne's question is basically spot on with what they're doing with this information. They're using it to control people. I mean, people, you know, they keep saying, well, if you haven't done anything wrong, you have nothing to fear. Well, that's totally irrelevant. The only thing that makes any difference is whether or not you're doing something to irritate the central regime. And if you are, they will use all this data against you. And I use the case that they're going against the bankers, putting them, you know, charging them criminally with defrauding people back in 2007, 2008. You can look at the others like Petraeus, like Jim Risen, Jim Rosen, the AP, other kinds of reporters who have been intimidated and threatened. all of that is they're taking this material and using that to do that. Or they're using it against the Tea Party or the Occupy group or other kinds of politically active groups that they don't want to be active.
Yes, sir.
You know, this is really the insidious part of it. When they allow the collection and acquisition of data and content information as well as metadata, it's not just metadata, there's content as well on everybody in the planet.
To be able to intimidate and shut everybody down, absolutely, an iron fist. What would have Hitler or Stalin have done with this? In closing, and I want to get Wayne a final question. Haven't they, in a way, and we're not endorsing the police state or the surveillance grid, dug their own pit? Because good people in government, and I concur with what you first said months ago, it's true, it's not the Russians. It's people in our own government, corporations, the Democratic Party that are leaking info, it's come out, that are exposing this. Haven't they, with this Panopticon spy grid, built the engine of their own destruction? Won't it be their arrogance that's their final downfall?
Yes, it can very easily be, simply because all the information is there about them, too. So, I mean, I would also make one more point, Alex, if I could.
Yes, sir.
all this trouble in the Ukraine, you know, you can use this data also to enable things like regime change. And, for example, when, you know, the Undersecretary of State was saying Yats is our guy, well, Yats eventually became the next head of the Ukraine. So it kind of implies that they were involved in some way in making that come to pass. Which, of course, irritated the Russians. You can understand that. And even later on, when they violated the agreement they had with the Russians about not inviting anybody like the Ukraine into NATO, then they go ahead and do that, too. So, obviously, they're doing some things to, like, irritate the the big bear, you know, Russia. So, I mean, they're not, it's not just a one-sided issue here. We played our part too. And this information, I think, is a part of that and that process of how they're doing this.
Well, sir, you did an amazing job on the film as the technical advisor on Snowden. Congratulations. Please come back soon. I'm going to come back with Wayne Madsen after this, but William Benny, thank you so much for your time at goodamerican.org, the film coming out next February. William Benny, thank you so much.
Yeah, well, thank you, and thanks for having me.
You bet. I'll say bye to you in the break if you can hold one moment. Didn't get Wayne's last question, but I'll have plenty to say when we come back. Investigative journalist Wayne Madsen, straight ahead. That was William Benny saying it's a global government corporate takeover using information warfare. The globalists have really screwed up. They were so arrogant early on with their corporate media control that they would write books to brag to each other. I mean, some of them bestsellers about, yeah, the public scum. We run the Democrats and Republicans. We're setting up a world government. Yeah, we're poisoning the food and water. Yeah, we ship the drugs in. Yeah, we destabilize Mexico. Look at them. They'll all come up here poor, begging for stuff. We'll implode the wages here. I mean, just the arrogance of them is going to undo them. And it is. People in corporations, people in the Democratic Party, people in the telecoms that are exposing all this. There's so many leaks coming out. That's why Soros and Hillary are all panicking. And their answer is to try to go take a few sad events with police and hype them all up to burn down cities. That backfired. It woke the police up. The police kind of went from a globalist halfway mind control position in the last few years, are like totally awake. Everything they're doing is blowing up in their face. The bottom of the hour, a very special report. I'm just going to stop there and leave it. I want to go to Wayne Madsen, who's been riding shotgun with us. I wanted to get him on a little early so he could ask a few questions. But I tell you, Wayne, was that not an amazing interview with Benny? I mean, the former head of the NSA coming out and saying it's a global corporate takeover, transferring our sovereignty and our information to a foreign system. It's treason. I mean, wow, that's powerful.
Well, absolutely it was. You know, when I was at the NSA, I very rarely had any contact with people in the higher echelons like Bill Binney. The only time I'd see them were at, like, defense conferences and trade shows, and that was only idle chit-chat if I ever did get to talk to him. But he was the real deal. He was in the technical and policy branch of NSA, and he and others from NSA and others from the CIA have come out and the Defense Intelligence Agency, including General Flynn, who you just mentioned, have come out and said what an awful situation we see today. And now I would note that John Brennan, reportedly the CIA director, wants to continue in that role under Hillary Clinton if she's elected. And here's a guy who just admitted he voted for Communist Party candidate Gus Hall in 1976.
And by the way, I'm sure that was his cover, but they say he actually became a Wahhabist and joined Islam. And I heard that. It was later partially confirmed. Now he admits he was a communist. I mean, what the hell's going on here?
Well, here, I think the fact that he admitted he voted for a guy like Gus Hall, and Gus Hall was not he wasn't even a committed communist. He was probably a government agent, like three quarters of the members of this Communist Party USA. But anyway, for him to admit that, a guy who came up through Catholic schools, who came from an Irish immigrant family, went to Fordham in New York, for him to say he voted for a communist, and then for him to deny charges that he embraced Wahhabist Islam when he was a CIA station chief in Riyadh, I think just goes to show that this guy has no moral turpitude.
That's it. We know what he is. He's a chameleon.
Yes, of course. So he'll change his spots according to what benefits him and his cabal, whatever that cabal may be. In 1976, I believe he probably he might have been trying to infiltrate the Communist Party.
I think that's what it was.
And now he's a friend of the Wahhabis and the jihadis. And
what do you make of Obama saying he's going to veto 9/11 families being able to sue the Saudis when his confirmed role in 9/11?
Well, at the same time, he's going to veto the JASTA bill. He wants to push through over a $1 billion military aid package for Saudi Arabia. So this guy takes his orders, obviously, from the Saudis. And look, I was in the school in Jakarta where he used to pray to Mecca and recite from the Quran. In 2011, I didn't want to believe that he got taken in, but I do believe now that he is at least a sympathizer, if not a practicing Sunni Muslim.
Another Lawrence of Arabia.
Yeah, and we know why Lawrence of Arabia made common ground with the Saudis.
He liked to screw little boys.
He was a pedophile. And he saw, the Saudis are too. If that hadn't been the case, Arabia would be under the control of the much more moderate Hashemites today instead of the Saudis.
Why did British intelligence in 1903 choose that particular tribe of Bedouin caravan robbers? I mean, that's who they were, to form that empire. I mean, why did they choose that group of miscreants?
Well, two reasons. One, I already mentioned, T.E. Lawrence was well-disposed towards pedophilia. He saw that the Saudis practiced it as well. And also, the British chose the most radical group, the Saudi Wahhabis, because these were jihadist holy warriors who they knew would bring down the Ottoman Empire, which they helped to do. And that was the beginning of the end for the Middle East. We saw the rise of European colonies, which led to nationalism.
That's right. So they were the destabilizer who wiped stuff up. Then the colonists would come in as the saviors after it. The Saudis would stand down and give them the area. They've been good little agents, haven't they?
Oh, yeah, they have from the very beginning. And, of course, the Saudis were all part of the partitioning of the Arab world into various...
What do you make of Flynn? And obviously he represents a larger army movement. I mean, I'll give people, obviously the globalists know this. I'm not talking about a secret. The U.S. Army, which 1775 actually predates the country. It's the oldest institution. Certainly not perfect. It knows where all the bodies are buried. It is the senior military organization. It sees itself as America. It certainly is, let's just not say spring chicken when it comes to things are not perfect. But I'm told, and I've seen the intelligence going on, that the army is just very close to kicking the globalist out, just very close. And then you see the real action with them, you know, exposing Obama, leaking stuff, exposing Hillary, not going along with the takeover of Syria. And it's got the Marine Corps halfway involved and some other, you know, groups starting to back it. That's got to really scare the globalist.
Yeah, I think especially when you mention the army, I think the opposition to regime change and getting involved in these is the group in the army that has to go bear the brunt of this, and that's U.S. Army Special Forces, Green Beret personnel. And I think that's where most of the opposition, thankfully, is coming from, because why should they give up their lives?
Well, you know, it's beyond that. They're actually having to train Wahhabists that say, I'm going to kill you next. I mean, they're giving tow missiles to Al-Qaeda. They're like, this is too much. We're not doing this.
Right. And we just saw special forces get thrown out of one Syrian town by our good allies, the Syrian rebels, the so-called Free Syrian Army. I always said that's a joke. There are no moderate Syrian rebels. There is.
Colonel Schaefer did the classified briefings. I can talk about it because it came out later. But he was on the same day he did the classified briefings. And a year later, came out that he was the one leading the briefing. And he was there in Congress. And they said, listen, it's 98% are Wahhabist funded by Saudi Arabia. There are no real rebels. That's why they later came out and said they spent like $50 million and got four non Al-Qaeda rebels.
Right, right. And not only the Saudis, we know the Turks have been involved in that too. And that's, of course, NATO. Turkey's a NATO country. So we've got our fingerprints all over this mess we created, and of course.
So how much does that shake Hillary up, though, and the globalists to know that the intelligence agencies, everybody's turning against them? And I'm not lionizing them, romanticizing them, but the intelligence agencies now realize the plan really is to destroy America, and they're having that come to Jesus moment, I think.
Yeah, and you know, that Obama speech to the UN was very interesting, because he provided clues as to what the priorities will be for the Obama Center and Presidential Library in Chicago.
And that's transfer our power through the TPP.
Yes, free trade, breaking down borders, mass migration, anti-populism. And he said, it's right wing and far left. He included both in that, anti-nationalism.
That's any nationalists that don't agree with foreign people ruling it.
Absolutely.
Good luck winning that fight, jackass.
Yeah, and that's going to be the focus. This is going to get tons of money from Soros this center in South Chicago in Jackson Park. And, you know, unlike the Carter Center, which has been monitoring elections, and they're fairly benign. You've got the Clinton Center, which is basically an extortion and kickback scheme. That's bad enough. But this Obama Center is going to be the most active presidential center and library we've seen in history.
Oh, yeah. You think the Clinton Foundation has been a cancer. Get ready.
Yeah, yeah. This one will make the Clinton Center look like a daycare center.
Well, you can tell Obama's excited. He's graduating to the next level of wrecking ball. I mean, you think things are bad now. We'll come back and talk about this because this is it, folks. But listen, you've got the UK, you got the US, you've got all 25 members of the EU now trying to pull out of the EU. You've got the Russians that already pulled out. That's why they're claiming anybody that wants to pull out from this global corporate government's a Russian spy. No, we're just agreeing with the Russians. We're not going to be under your butt anymore. They're panicking. I don't want to be too optimistic, but this global government looks like it's dead on arrival. I don't see how they can put it back together again. The problem is they may just destroy the planet in the process of trying to stay in power. I'm going to ask Wayne Madsen where he sees all this going straight ahead. But I tell you, it's always darkest before the dawn, folks. We've got a ton of breaking news. It's all coming up in the next segment. This last 30 minutes that I'm hosting, I may have to co-host with Anthony in the fourth hour. It's going to be so jam-packed. Zach Galifianakis, the guy from Hangover, a funny comedian. He has, I guess, a rat leaving the sinking ship. He's really thrown Hillary under the bus, which is a good thing. More and more that's happening. Democrats prepare for the fall of Hillary. That's coming up in the next segment. I have Hillary the maniac. Drudge is reporting on her having these breakdowns, acting weirder and weirder. That's coming up in the next segment. We're going to premiere that here. It's going to go up on YouTube as well. Not just her latest freak out, but others composited together. Wayne, you've always got your ear to the ground. A lot of amazing sources when you're up there on Capitol Hill in between, you know, there in Virginia and Florida. You know, the Secret Service, we have real sources just like you do. You work for InfoWars. Hell, you were there with us in Cleveland. The Secret Service said, hey, we're going to get you info in the next few weeks. Well, it took them a month, and it was like, she's falling down every hour, sometimes more. She's having convulsions. We don't know. Parkinson's, we're not sure. Then the emails came out, Parkinson's and other stuff. Brain tumors, we've got that from medical doctors in Virginia and Maryland. I'm just going to stop. This is serious business. What is your intel on her and her deterioration and what she's planning to do or where this is going? Other key points, Wayne Madsen.
Well, I've talked to many medical people. Of course, they all preface this by saying we can't really make a diagnosis without, you know, seeing her personally and seeing her records, which we're not going to see. But it's almost uniformly they're saying that she's suffering from some sort of neurological seizure issue. Now, whether that's epilepsy or Parkinson's, they don't know. But they pointed out that the pneumonia that she has is probably as a result of that epiglottal flap that keeps fluid that should go to the stomach from going into the lungs. And it was fluid that went into her lower lungs that resulted in the pneumonia. Now, and she takes medication to try to stem that problem. But I really believe she's going to be pretty well drugged up for the debate.
Well, that's my next question. If she can't for a week before show up in person and has to do satellite or Skype appearances to people now, how's she going to be 90 minutes toe-to-toe live with Donald Trump? I don't think she can make it next week.
Well, I think she's actually, her people are fearing this. Look, you know, I think the Democrats ought to think of really, you know, it's cruel what they're doing to her. Pull her off the ticket, get her medical treatment. But I believe that Bill Clinton wants to be the Edith Galt Wilson of this next administration. Edith Galt Wilson, of course, was Woodrow Wilson's wife, the first lady.
She really ran it.
She ran the country. I think Bill Clinton wants to be that same.
And
that
exactly, because Hillary's so strong-willed, she used to run him. He's kind of glad she's so sick now. This is my chance to finally be president.
Right, right. I think that's what's going to happen. I also think this is going to be a very close election, and I think we got to look at it's so close. I think we have to look at small states could throw this thing. You know, Maine splits up its electoral votes by congressional district. That's possibly one vote already for Trump. I would also look at these states where they say there's a hidden Trumpocrat electorate, particularly states like Rhode Island and New Jersey, and especially after the bombings in New Jersey by by the Afghani jihadists. Look, the people in Jersey are going to not vote thinking about lane closures on the George Washington Bridge, which the Democrats are hyping right now.
Sure.
They're going to worry about bombing.
Well, I mean, what's wrong with Hillary saying it isn't a bombing and the same Senate saying it's a bombing and then saying the Russians? Did you hear this? Where they're saying the Russians are behind it?
Yeah, well, she's getting this from Huma Abedin, you know, who's her sort of her Svengali, who tells her, look, you know, you
her can't Rasputin, her Rasputin winds her up and, you know.
Yeah, right. Well, I mean, she has this bizarre worldview that that the people she thinks are the enemies of this United States they're really our friends, and people who are supposedly, in her view, our friends are really our enemies, like the Saudis, like the Turks and these other countries. She's really messed up. Look, I think, as I said, I think this is going to be a very close election. It's going to boil down to some small states that never really made a difference before. It's always been Ohio and Florida. I would look at Rhode Island. I would look at that one district in Maine. I would look at Delaware, which is now leaning Democrat from solid Democrat. Look, I think.
Well, I mean, what does it tell you when she was 20-something points ahead in the Google poll for years? You know, when she got polled, even before Trump got in, you know, the Democrats were always ahead. Now she's only a few points ahead of Trump, about to lose the District of Criminals. I mean, even the District of Columbia, Hillary's about to lose. I mean, what does that tell you?
Yeah, if she can't count on D.C. or Rhode Island or Delaware, she's in trouble.
All right, WayneMadsenReport.com. Thanks for coming in with your great questions for William Binney, former leader, technical director of the NSA. A big show so far. We got an hour and a half left. WayneMadsenReport.com. Thank you, Tripp. You're doing a great job.
You bet.
Thanks. So good to have folks like that on the team. I'm so proud of that guy. This whole crew is amazing. We'll be back. All right. I want to get into Zach Galifianakis, again, of The Hangover, an incredible comedian and actor, who did some softball interviews with Obama on his Between Two Ferns satire show. Now, Obama got that it was satire, so it went good for him. Hillary didn't get it because she's not the Hillary she was. Hey, a bunch of strokes, a bunch of hitting your head, a bunch of... And I was in some fights when I was a young man for about a week or so. I couldn't even think. So, you know, brain injury is a serious animal. We're going to be talking about that. Hillary Clinton jokes that she shouldn't have come on the show. I'm going to play this first, and then an incredible report Rob Dew put together that is going up on Infowars.com as we speak. I'm going to tell you about that report in a few minutes. Before we go any further, ladies and gentlemen, we are extending because listeners keep asking us to, and that's fine. We want to do it. There's a big buzz for Super Male and Super Female Vitality. If you'll just get a bottle of it, you can't lose because you're funding the tip of the spear, exposing globalism, fighting for a free press, a free open internet. Everything we're doing is turning to solid gold right now politically. Everything the New World Order does turns to solid lead. It's collapsing. And Supermail is organic, known super herbs and compounds that naturally and healthily go in there and basically do the opposite of the estrogen mimickers. And women got too much estrogen, so do men. I'm not getting into the technicals. All I know is it works. Weight loss, stamina, energy is what it's done for myself. Libido, crazy. And I don't even need help in that department, I'll be quite frank with you. But it's dramatic. We're extending it by listener request, Super Male Vitality and Super Female Vitality, through the weekend. InfoWarsLive.com. InfoWarsStore.com is the umbrella site for all the products. You can find a link to the nutraceuticals and supplements there. But InfoWarsLive.com will take you right there. We also have 50% off the Made in America, Make America Free Again knockoff hats of Trump. I mean, Make America Great Again, yeah, we got to be free again. So I made these or some other products. They're selling out quickly. We're doing 50% off right now, the Made in America hats. The things cost me like $10 a piece. We're selling them for $14.98. Also, we have Secret 12, the great methical bottle and vitamin B12 taken under the tongue so you get better absorption. That's 20% off. InfoWars Live went to number 30 so far. It's been out 2.5 days on the Apple charts, even better, I'm told, on the Droid charts. It has an incredible 96% approval rating, or 5 stars, on Android, and 5 pure stars, at least when I checked last night, we have screenshots of it. Downloaded by over 100,000 people on Apple, about 50,000 on Droid. and it's available for free. Video feeds, audio feeds, you name it. We're going to be adding more features. But it's just great because if it goes to number one in free apps, then it has a lensing effect, an amplifying effect where millions will download it. So I won't take a year to get a million downloads of it. I can do it in a week. That's the whole point of getting a book to number one or anything to number one, because then all these people that aren't aware of what's going on say, what is this? For some reason, Apple listed it as a magazine and entertainment. We didn't do that. We're trying to change its listing to news and information, but whatever. Get the InfoWars Live app. There's a lot of other free apps other people made and stuff in there, one of our older free apps. It's fine. It's audio and text, you know, articles. But InfoWars Live is the new one. InfoWarsStore.com has links to it. InfoWars.com/app. That's InfoWars.com/app. If you're a member of the InfoWars daily newsletter with all the free videos and articles and promo codes and the rest of it and info we send out, it's important that we have the old, you know, old-fashioned, low-tech, high-tech emails in case there is censorship, we can get a hold of you. So if you sign up there, we'll also send you the direct link to the Droid and iPhone store to get InfoWars Live free. So that's what it comes down to. Thank you all for your support, for your high ratings. It is a great app, and more is going to be added to it in the near future. InfoWars Live, get it today. The next step, one more brick in the fight, building our defenses against the globalists, but offensively taking action. And then finally, one of our great sponsors for 15-plus years, Solutions from Science Solar Summer Sale. Quite frankly, I got so busy, I didn't plug it for 2 weeks. And then they said, we want to leave you as a sponsor. You haven't plugged this. And I said, oh, I'll just extend the sale. I'll do it. So summer ended yesterday. Today's the first day of fall, but this is extended maybe a week, maybe 2 weeks. They have a whole bunch of the best solar panel systems and control units. They're always updating what they've got. They're very, very popular here in advertised nationwide. They got a bunch of other great systems, wind turbines, EMP bags, not just so you survive EMP, but so your cell phones and stuff don't track you when you aren't using them. Smart LED light bulbs, the latest design. Buy one perfect power package and use coupon code ALEX to receive another one absolutely free. That's a big deal. SummerSolarSale.com. SummerSolarSale.com or call toll-free 877-327-0365. 877-327-0365. 65, same number they had 15, 16 years ago when I first started working with Solutions from Science. Okay, and again, thank you for supporting our sponsors. That's how we fund this operation. So you can't lose because you're buying war bonds with a group of people, let's just be honest, that are completely committed to a craze level. I mean, I don't have any fear. I'm not bragging, it's just really good to be in this position. Other men I know are just so afraid of everything. Even if they're strong physically, they just think being timid and just scared of everything is just the way to get ahead in life. And we built this country and we built civilization by being bold. And we're going to bring it back. So the men have returned. Get ready. Now, getting into Hillary. We've got a special report coming up in a few minutes on her. Eyes pointing different directions, falling down. We told you that a month before it came out. She's falling down more than once an hour, epileptic stuff, brain tumor is the word. We're very sad for her personally, but the arrogance that she could get away with this, the Secret Service agent jumping up when somebody asks her a question, she kind of trances out. That's all coming up because we have General Flynn coming out basically saying she's a psychotic. Now, Zach Galifianakis, if I'm pronouncing that right, came out with his new Between Two Ferns, funny satire show. I think he does it like once a month. And it's funny. I'm a fan of the guy. Obama has done a couple with him, but went along with the humor so it didn't go bad. Hillary cognitively has got so many problems that she doesn't understand that it's satire, so it derails very quickly. And she says, quote, I really regret doing this. When he makes jokes about, hey, you want people's guns. Well, she's on record that she does. So even the little, you know, leftist comedians cannot prop her up again. So let's play this. I'll analyze it in live time. Here is Hangover Star talking to Hitlery. Between Two Ferns with Zach Galifianakis. Here comes Mr. Galifianakis.
Where is he? Where's Zach?
Oh, it's the Grim Reaper coming over to her.
I have to edit this because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
I'm sure that isn't lost on her.
She's trying to put
the message there. thing I just said a few weeks ago. The Grim Reaper's hanging over.
Halloween spirit of it all.
I have to stop this because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
Is that a good idea around the Secret Service? Are you okay?
I'm fine. First, let's start. Hi, welcome to another...
I have to stop this because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see this.
Their edition of Between Two Ferns. I'm your host, Zach Galifianakis, and my guest today is Hillary Clinton.
You know, he copies Gavin
Thank
McGinnis.
Thank you very much, Mrs.
I have to stop this because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see this.
Clinton, for me, critics have questioned some of your decision-making recently, and by you doing this show, I hope it finally lays that to rest.
He is copying McGinnis.
It absolutely proves that case, don't you?
You start advice.
Are you excited to be the first girl president?
Well, I mean, be...
I have to stop this because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see this.
Being president would be such an extraordinary honor and responsibility.
And crime operation.
But... being the first woman elected president and what that would mean for our country and particularly what that would mean for, you know, not just little girls.
I have to stop this because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
Little boys, too. That's pretty special.
Mm-hmm. Not to take away from the historic significance of you perhaps becoming the first female president, but for a younger generation, you all...
I have to stop this because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see this.
Also become their first white president, and that's pretty neat, too. As secretary, how many words per minute could you type? And how does President Obama like his coffee? Like himself?
I have to keep stopping this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
A little sexist joke.
You know, Zach, those are really out-of-date questions.
See, the black men are bad.
You need to get out more.
What happens
if you become pregnant? She still can't
handle it. Are we going to be stuck with Tim Kaine for not?
I have to keep stopping this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see this.
9 months, how does this work?
I could send you some pamphlets that might help you understand.
First, you supported Obama.
Oh, she's the first woman who was a first lady, then to become president.
I think that...
I have to keep stopping this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see this video.
She was already president before.
Are you down with TPP?
I'm not down with TPP.
Oh, really? Even though you helped write it?
You're supposed to say.
I have to stop this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
Yeah, you know me. Like the hip-hop group.
Don't then they make fun of Jimmy Fallon.
Fine, lose.
Which is other government propaganda, which Funny or Die is.
Let's talk about Trump.
Let's.
I have to keep stopping this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
When you see how well it works for Donald Trump, do you ever think to yourself, oh, maybe I should be more racist? When he's elected president,
like George Soros.
I have to keep stopping this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
Funding all this.
Secretary of State, are you going to move to Canada? Or one of the Arctics?
Hit pause. Back it up. You know, this is supposed to be ironic. This is not ironic. I mean, I can come up with this stuff in 10 seconds and have better stuff.
I have to keep stopping this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
To ask her. It's just all, oh, I'm a male saying bad things to a woman. Oh, you're going to be the first woman. Oh, shouldn't you just be more racist when George Soros and her are the ones pumping the whole race narrative 24/7, their own emails say to create race war on the...
I have to keep stopping this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
Country as a diversion from them doubling black unemployment. I mean, I said I liked, you know, this extinct dinosaur, Zalophanucus, but Zach Zalophanucus...
I have to keep stopping this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube... they don't want you to see it.
Is just as dumb as the people that think that, you know, the Trump sons, Eric and Donald Trump Jr., are actually out hunting extinct creatures like Triceratops.
I have to keep stopping this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
Well, you're an extinct fake comedian fop that I now coin the Zookus Foul Fraudus Kapoopus.
I have to keep stopping this video because Google-controlled YouTube doesn't want you to see it. Aren't they nice?
That I get is a derivative of Gavin McGinnis, who was around decades ago and is the original Trendy. And this actor, we should go back to him, see him 5-6 years ago before he took on this form, was not that.
I have to keep stopping this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
Gavin McGinnis know this guy's stolen his identity? Let's continue with another dinosaur posing as a modern Trendy.
Or one of the Arctics.
I would stay in the United States.
And what would you try to?
Try to prevent him from destroying the United States.
I have to keep stopping this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
So you're going to lead the Civil War?
No, I wouldn't take up arms. I think that might be a little extreme.
Oh, right. Because you were saying before we were rolling that you wanted to take away everyone's guns. Very cool. Cool, cool, cool.
I really regret doing this.
The scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see this video.
Any regrets over losing the Scott Baio vote?
All right, let's hit pause. Back it up to the gun thing. Everyone's acting like this was real and she couldn't handle it. But if you really watch it closely, this is all completely scripted. They want to make it ironic and uncomfortable so everyone watches it.
Scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see this segment of the Alex Jones Show.
But maybe he's not really a bad guy because he didn't come over as the Grim Reaper. I'm not sure. Doesn't really matter, does it? It just matters that he stole his identity from Gavin McGinnis. Let's go back to it.
No, I wouldn't take up arms. I think that might be a little extreme.
You'd have somebody else do it. You'd send Al-Qaeda in to kill tens of thousands of Christians and people in Syria and then make jokes about you came, we saw he died, right? Continue.
Before we were rolling that you wanted to take away everyone's guns. Very cool. Cool, cool, cool.
Very cool.
I really regret doing this.
Any regrets over losing the Scott Baio vote?
Not a one.
So it wasn't heartbreaking.
Pause again.
No.
Notice they tape the mic on and make it look like she's low tech. It's an access show between the two Ferns, not the establishment Hollywood speaking to you, because they know how discredited they are. So it's all about, oh, access TV, oh, a funny, non-threatening, modern beatnik. Oh, the thing's taped on. Oh, let's continue analyzing this.
Oh, yeah, but Chachi, I mean, who's going to be next? Max Headroom? I'd love to meet the person who makes your pantsuits.
Oh, really?
Very malice.
Yeah, because for Halloween, I wanted to go as a librarian from outer space.
That would be malice. I think
that'd be a good look on you.
Have you thought about what you're going to be wearing at the debates?
I have to keep stopping this because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see this.
You know, there's this thing called the double standard, and so I think about, well, what should the first woman...
Pause. It's all back to women and what they wear, and that we're against women, and we're bringing up women. Blah, blah, blah. No, they ask people what kind of tie you're going to wear. It's all this crap. Go back to the
nominee of one of our two major parties wear to the debate, and I have no idea. So if you've got suggestions, I'm open to them.
Do you wonder what your opponent?
Oh yeah, she doesn't have any focus groups or image groups. I mean, she's not a communist Chinese agent who gets up in debates wearing actual 1960s Maoist state garb made in China. I mean, you can Google it. Hillary wears Maoist Chinese garb. She's not wearing it this time. You're like, well, that's a bunch of communists. She's this woman's worth hundreds of millions of dollars. Well, so are the communist generals over there. Let's go back to this parasite.
Might be wearing. I mean,
I assume you'll wear, you know, that red power tie.
Or maybe like a white power tie.
That's even more appropriate.
Oh, yeah, this is a pause. So we're injecting that white people are bad and racist because there's a white guy running for president. We're the little race pimps that think everybody's dumb, and we're going to sit here and manage everybody all day. Let's go back to the Diplodocus, Finucus,
Donald
Sackers.
Trump's wedding. Did he write his own vows? And did Michelle Obama write Melania's?
I really couldn't see or hear very well, so I'm not quite sure what his vows were, but I'm sure they were great and huge and wonderful.
Like his vows.
I have to pause this video because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see it.
Chelsea, your daughter, and Ivanka Trump, Trump's daughter, are friends. Does Ivanka ever call Chelsea, you know, to talk about boys that might have crushes on her, like her dad?
I don't think so.
What's going to be the number one focus of your presidency?
Oh, Zach, it has to be the economy. We need more good jobs with rising
income. Yeah, you've just been running Texas the 90s.
I have to pause this because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see Hillary bullshitting through her teeth.
Economy work for everybody,
you
not
created
just
the bubble.
Those
we
at
need
the top.
To take it. We need to take
you
a
stole
break.
The Haitian
we
money.
To have a
only 5.7%.
Washington is broken. The truth is too many politicians are totally controlled by special interests and lobbyists. We're going to make America great again. I'm Donald Trump, and I approve this message.
And the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want this Trump commercial out. So, F you, YouTube and Google, and, of course, Hillary.
He approves the message.
Why would you play a commercial for my opponent in the middle of our interview?
To be fair.
He paid me in steaks.
I'd be afraid to eat them if I were you.
It's a good cut of meat. I think it's part of the asshole. Well, this has been a lot of fun, Mrs. Clinton. We should stay in touch. What's the best way to reach you? Email?
I have to pause this because the scumbags at Google-controlled YouTube don't want you to see this video. F you, YouTube.
I mean, they act like it's trending because he's got a beard. It's really funny. He does some funny comedy. That was not it. I think that...
Not funny. F you, YouTube, and Google.
He's trending because he's got a beard. It's really funny. He does some funny comedy. That was not it. I think this thing fell on his face. Is a total joke, but we just analyzed it and broke it down because they're involved in politics now. So it's, you know, fair game. But to Zach Galifianakis... Thank God I'm not you. That's all I got to say. Okay, let's get into serious information now. It's going up on Infowars.com, I'm told. Is it up now? As we speak. It's going up as we speak. I was told it was going up. Can we call Rob Duan? Drum roll, please. I'm skipping this network break. This is so important. Because this is going to be a day long. Remember, this is important information. And I met this morning, and I met during the show, and I met 20 minutes ago, and I was told that as we speak on Infowars.com that this video was going up because I want the radio listeners, thank you, a giant, massive group of patriots of every race, color, and creed that love freedom to get this out. We're going to air this here, but if you're a radio listener, want to see it and share it, General warns Hillary is psychotic. Top military officials warn Clinton is unfit to be president. And this ties into her having a latest breakdown where she came out and said, let me quote her exactly here for you. Why aren't I 50 points ahead? So here is the evidence of this woman bombed out of her brain so she doesn't have convulsions every 15 minutes. They have heavy, heavy drugs. I got to hand it to her, battling through, fighting through it, wearing her little Maoist outfit. This is Hillary Rodham Clinton. This is the compilation we're premiering now. Just went live on Infowars.com. We're putting it on Facebook. We're putting it on Twitter. I want a maximum push. Top generals warn she's psychotic. They're claiming Trump's going to cause a nuclear war when he's once detente, and all these foreign leaders say this is great, when he had the proper strategy to take out ISIS, now being followed, when he was against the Iraq war in 2003 and Hillary was for it. He's the warmonger. They made that up about Barry Goldwater when he was anti-war, when it was LBJ starting the wars. Same deal. No, you're the one that the actual generals are worried about with the nuclear buttons. Let's go ahead and play the clip.
Hillary Clinton, she is unfit to be president of the United States and commander in chief. If there was a temperament problem for anybody who watched the commander in chief's town hall a week or so ago, now you saw the temperament rise up in Hillary Clinton. And you saw her when she stood up on the stage there to argue with the individual, the great, I believe the gentleman that asked the question was out of the Navy or a Navy veteran. Now, tough question. And she lost her temper. She lost her temper. And that's something that I think we have to pay very close attention to. We cannot have that kind of judgment in the White House.
As a naval flight officer, I held a top secret sensitive compartmentalized information clearance. And that provided me access to materials and information highly sensitive to our warfighting capabilities. Had I communicated this information not following prescribed protocols, I would have been prosecuted and imprisoned. Secretary Clinton, how can you expect those such as myself, who were and are entrusted with America's most sensitive information, to have any confidence in your leadership as president when you clearly corrupted our national security?
Well, I appreciate your concern and also your experience, but let me try to make the distinctions that I think are important for me to answer your question. First, as I said to Matt, you know and I know, classified material is designated, it is marked, there is a header so that there is no dispute
at all. And it was marked. It was marked.
What is being communicated to or from someone who has that access is marked classified.
And more emails are coming up.
And what we have here is the use of an unclassified system by hundreds of people in our government to send information that was not marked.
That's the model. They all commit crimes, so it's okay.
There was no statement, top secret, secret, or confidential. I communicated about classified material on a wholly separate system. I took it very seriously.
A secret system.
When I traveled, I went into one of those little tents that I'm sure you've seen around the world, because we didn't want there to be any potential for someone to have embedded a camera to try to see whatever it is
like
that
the guy the gas station when
that
you put your credit with your credit card
designated, marked, and headed as classified.
Let us
so move. I did exactly what I should have done, and I take it very seriously. Always have, always will.
Sir, thank you. Thank you.
And how did you talk about Vice Presidential possibilities?
I was very
proud of that. Did you talk about Vice
Hillary acting like a clown, videos of that. Radio listeners at InfoWars.com, get the full video.
You're okay. Keep talking, you handle it, we're not going anywhere.
Okay, here we are. Marsha Fudge for hosting us.
She's totally insane. That's a monster. That's what evil does to you. Here come her babies. She's about to give birth.
Ah, thank you, Master. Oh. Mommy. Oh, thank you, Mommy. The planet is ours. Oh, little green goblets.
Hillary didn't fall down. Why, just look at her fall flat on her face. More at 9 on CNN. We don't lie. We're the Clinton News Network. Look, boom.
Ah.
Slow motion enhanced. Hillary falling down, but they just said she wobbled. She stumbled. She didn't fall down. Those conspiracy theorists, those enemies, lied. Hillary's never been stronger. Did you hear she climbed Mount Everest last week? She did, actually. It's true. I mean, she climbed it with Jeff Galifianakis. Enhanced of the feet behind her being dragged into the vehicle. Emblematic fall of the New World Order. A portent. An omen, a tea leaf, a rune, a signet, a symbol, a sign, a star. The scum of the globalists will rule no one. She's coming out saying she's fine. No one's around her. Everyone's blocked off. But a child runs up to hug her.
What happened?
Oh,
It's not staged.
It's a beautiful day in New York.
We don't lie here on the Running Man.
You can put half of Trump's supporters into what I call the basket of deplorables. Right?
And you can put us all in there.
The racist, sexist, homophobic, xenophobic, Islamophobic, you name it.
Hillary for president!
Let's make it happen. Installing half a billion solar panels. Building a cleaner, more resilient electric grid. Not hold you back. But as you know better than most, tuition keeps going through the roof and debt keeps piling up.
Boy, we have 63 days to go.
46 now, sweetheart. That day she was in the tent for 45.
Enough. A four-year degree should not be the only path to a good job in America. About how hard it is to balance the demands of work and family in today's economy. Families look different today than they did decades ago. I think we can all agree. Most need two incomes just to get by.
And bargain collectively. And I will fight back against so-called right to work. Right to work is wrong for workers and wrong for America.
She's clearly nuts in this latest
video.
Now,
having said all this, why aren't I 50 points ahead, you might ask?
Who is this new woman?
Well, the choice for working families has never been clearer.
Like an alien.
I need your help to get Donald Trump's record out to everybody. Nobody should be fooled.
We'll be back with the rest of it. I mean, she is whacked out of her gourd. Fourth hour coming up, Infowars.com/show. Some of our affiliates don't carry it. We love them, support them. Stay with us. Big specials running right now to support the broadcast. So if you're receiving this transmission, you are watching Hillary Clinton rot on the vine in front of everyone. Metaphysically, a mirror image like the portrait of Mr. Gray showing the inward evil projecting itself out into the third dimension. You know, there's a point I wanted to get to with William Binney earlier on how to defeat the technocracy, and that's voting with our dollars. Google Glasses failed, and they had billions of dollars pushing that. People didn't like it. It wasn't something that hooked into humanity good. It didn't work well. It was nauseating, both spiritually and physically. And they come out as con artists and say, you will just accept driverless cars. And okay, the feds do plan to just make everybody in the next 5 to 10 years get out of your car. And okay, we're going to do it. How about we just don't comply? They all just con artists and say, you'll all accept Google Glasses. This is going to replace the internet. Didn't happen. Oh, driverless cars, just accept it. But you know what? I'm not going to take baseball bats to driverless cars when I see them. They usually double as little mobile spy centers to steal your data. I'm going to find out who's in business with them, and I'm going to boycott them. And we're going to be launching next week a major global movement against the technocracy. We're going to crowdsource. I mean, that's Buckley's idea. I just want to come out with a symbol. I'm coming out with a symbol. Somebody else can just send us the symbol if you got a better one. Of products having a marking on them that means humans were involved in its cultivation, development, and delivery. I'm not going to buy any products that were not delivered by a human driver and loaded by humans. You say, well, that's in the way of progress. Yeah, I'd all be for driverless cars if the globalists didn't say it was about getting rid of humans in the chain of development and building a world that isn't based on us. I want to build a world based on making things better for us, not making us obsolete because the elite think they're a bunch of gods. You're not a god, Hillary. You're not a god, Bezos. You're not a god, Schmidt. You're not a god, any of you people. If you want humanity to get out of the way, stick a gun in your mouth and blow your own damn head off. I don't wish any harm against you, but stop wishing harm on us. You are a bunch of trash. Raised by your asswipe parents, and you've had everything your whole life, and you have no soul, so just get out of our way, trash. I see you. You're husk. So, you want me to die? Not going to happen. By me physically dying, I don't care about this body. I'm saying I'm not going to join the forces of death and just roll over in some ditch for you. You understand, Cupcake? Let's finish up this clip of Hillary. The video's on Infowars.com. General warns Hillary is psychotic. Here's the end of it, where she had her latest little psycho event today. Couldn't even speak proper English. You know, here it is. She's talking like a two-year-old, because that's her spirit. Little demons about that smart. She says, why aren't I 50 points ahead? Here she is.
It's in bargain collectively. And I will fight back against so-called right to work. Right to work is wrong for workers and wrong for America. Now, having said all this, why aren't I 50 points ahead, you might ask? Well, the choice for working families has never been clearer.
But they got a green screen behind her.
I need your help to get Donald Trump's record.
She's on the toilet in her hospital room.
Nobody should be fooled. He proudly declared himself 100% right to work.
That is blue screen. I mean, I don't know if she's on the toilet.
He even hired a union-busting firm to break up an organizing campaign at his hotel in Las Vegas, where you are right now. And he built
up his wealth. How dare him bust up a union sucking off of him.
By stiffing small businesses and contractors. That goes against everything we stand for as a country. My dad was a small business. I'm just a businessman. I'm just happy he never did business with
Trump. She went back on all these different fake accents.
After fall, she boarded her plane yesterday. Clinton was leaving Yemen.
This is the heart of 1776.
It is. We're going to come back. Stay with me. I'm going to continue broadcasting. Anthony Gagliardi's coming up. This is The Resistance. All right, I want to hand the baton to Anthony Gagliardi because I've got a lot to get done today for the nightly news and preparations for next Monday, the historic debate. We're going to have coverage the hour before live. We're going to actually carry the feeds. We're going to actually just, you know, carry the feed, not just have commentary over it. Fair use. This is open to any media outlet that wants to pick it up and subscribe to it. Very, very exciting. And we're going to have a breakdown for several hours after with your phone calls and more. I'll be back this Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. I know tomorrow, too, I will be, but 4 to 6 p.m. Central with the Sunday transmission. I'll be live this weekend. I'm live a lot of weekends, or David and I comes in sometimes when I'm evil and actually take off for the weekend. But I tell you, I mean, I end up working on Saturdays, too, just because wild horses couldn't drag me away. We're going to see a lot of false flags, and we've asked, what are they going to do, start a race war? Well, yeah, they've come in and tripled down with hundreds of millions from the Ford Foundation and Soros to the communist organizations and Black Lives Matter and others, where a black cop shoots a black man with a gun, and Hillary tweets out, another black man killed by white police with a gun. Another unarmed black man killed by the police. And it just wasn't true. Now, you got the other case with this poor gentleman in Tulsa killed by a white female cop who just choked and killed him. I've got that Trump clip I want to play, but I want to finish these clips first because I mentioned them. We're going to play first Keith Lamont, Scott's brother, the guy that had the gun and got killed by the black officer in North Carolina and Charlotte, calls all white people devils. Then black thugs beat up white man in Charlotte as he begs for no reason. And MSNBC claims Black Lives Matter rioters are peaceful. If this wasn't so serious, this is some really good comedy. I mean, this is really good. Then we have Trump coming out. We have that clip. Trump coming out saying that, you know, he's got some really serious questions about what happened and thinks the lady choked and it was wrong what happened with this crutcher gentleman whose car's broke down. The cops show up, freak out. There's a lot of hype going on here. And it's a big black guy and he may try to kill us, but that's all Black Lives Matter in this hype. I'm not saying what she did's right, she should get in trouble, but it's like the cops' crime rates are exploding. Chicago already had the highest crime rate in the world. It's now doubled that in 2 years. Thousands dying a year. A couple hundred people get killed total by cops. Quote, in false shootings every year. It's 1,000 total. So the point is, this is a triumph of hype over reality. So let's go through these clips. Here is Keith Lamont. He looks like he's really enjoying all the hype. It's like, you know, it's this new party time to just come out and, you know, sit there in a city with a, you know, with a black police chief and a black city and just say it's all the white people. And have weirdo white people out there with signs saying white people did this. I mean, it really gets old, man. So let's play this clip.
Is there anything we should know?
No. You just know that all white people are f***ing devils.
And make sure you air that one.
Air that.
Don't take that.
All white cops are f***ing devils and white people.
Devils. I think we're all kind of devils. I mean, at least we have that part in us. But okay, I agree. It's only white people that ever do anything wrong. I get it. That's why 95% of the crime in Chicago is black on black. Thousands dead a year. But just, you know, forget it. Doesn't matter. You know, let's say cops, you know, kill 100-something black people a year. Let's say half of it's, you know, wrong. 100 people it's wrong. Okay, I'm sure there's some bad cops. It's all I ever hear about. It's like there's no businesses, there's no future, there's no culture, there's no nothing. It's just bitch and complain all day that the cops are out to get you. And it's like you own something when you have a, you know, a victimology. Oh, I'm people are putting me down. Oh, I don't know. You know, like these sports players, I only make $100 million on my contract and $10 million a year on sponsorship. The white people, like the white people that adopted me when I was a kid and put me through college, and they're evil. I'm sorry. Let's go to Black Thugs Beat Up White Devil as he begs. The begging's the best part. This is the racial assaults that are just epic right now in Charlotte, where Joe Biggs will be reporting tonight. Here it is. You have eight white guys beating a black person, it'd be big news. There would be riots nationwide. But, because collectively all whites would be involved. But no. If black people attack a white devil, it's okay. Well, this person's begging. Please. Okay, you just need to start packing. Let's continue here. Let's go to the next one. MSNBC claims Black Lives Matter rioters are peaceful. Kind of like when they had ISIS, Al-Qaeda, Muslim Brotherhood overthrow Egypt and kill tens of thousands of Christians and blow up every church in the country. It was good, CNN said. Or rather, an issue with the computer, so many of these clips. And then we've got Trump coming up as well. But while we cue that up, let's go ahead and play Trump talking about the real situation where a guy's car breaks down. Doesn't have a criminal record. He's got, four or five kids. He's a Christian guy. The cops, he puts his hands up and they just kill him. Trump very troubled by Oklahoma fatal police shooting. And they've got some leftist police chiefs coming out being screwballs, you know, saying he's wrong. So it's okay when they blame white people or whatever for the black cop and the black police chief shooting an armed black guy. That's okay when the left does it. When Trump says this looks pretty damn bad, we shouldn't have cops that choke. But he says there's still going to always be problems. That's another thing. Nothing's going to be perfect. But again, you got a real issue. Why do these Black Lives Matter people always pick a place where they're in the wrong? Because it's globalist run to never give them a legitimate issue and double cross the inner city blacks, you name it, later with the police state. They're being set up. They're the useful idiots like all of us. Here's Donald Trump.
I watched the shooting in particular in Tulsa. And that man was hands up. That man went to the car, hands up, put his hand on the car. I mean, to me, it looked like he did everything you're supposed to do. And he looked like a really good man. And maybe I'm a little clouded because I saw his family talking about him after the fact. So you get a little bit, you know, different image maybe. But to me, he looked like a, you know, somebody that was doing what they were asking him to do. And this young officer, I don't know what she was thinking. I don't know what she was thinking. But I'm very, very troubled by that. I'm very, very troubled by that. And we have to be very
concerned. So there, you know, there's Trump laying it all out. The video's on InfoWars. For some reason, it's a corrupted file. It won't play. That happens with computers. Sometimes you think we're like editing videos. I do too. They just kind of shudder and mess up. Sometimes they just are corrupted. It's weird. I got to download them like 8 times before they work. That one doesn't work. But the clip is on Infowars.com of MSNBC claims Black Lives Matter rioters are peaceful. But they call them demonstrators. This is like an exercise in being chumped, Anthony Gucciardi. It just gets crazier and crazier. What do you make of all this?
Well, this is what happens when the media gives people a license to do whatever they want because they make excuses, right? So if the rioters in Charlotte go out and they do something like beat up a white person who's screaming for his life, well, they say that the rioters are peaceful and they're peaceful protesters.
Or try to throw people in fires or attack reporters. They deserve it because they are evil.
Exactly, right? But they're peaceful. And when the media is apologetic for everything you do, you have a license. It's like if you look throughout history, a lot of the times people would go into movements in so-called revolutions, right? And they would initially not really want to do anything, but they realized the establishment system at that time was behind them, so they had a license to do whatever they want. Why wouldn't they go around and smash in cop cars and smash other cars?
That's right. The media, the government, George Soros, they all want this to happen. And so people feel like this is their time to shine. It's their time to get attention when they're actually setting everybody up, including themselves.
Well, and they forget that real people are actually watching and thinking that they're completely insane when they say things like someone, an entire race is devils, right? So people with actual brains are watching this and realizing how absurd it is. But when you have what seems to be such a mighty force of the establishment behind you, when MSNBC says you're peaceful and everything's fine, then you feel entitled to do that. You feel like you should do something. Like, we are peaceful. That's right. It's a just self-justification of delusion where it's like, you know what? It is peaceful. You know why? Because they deserve it. Because white people did this to us or whatever. I mean, it would just be equally as insane as a white person to say black people did this. I mean, it's totally, totally delusional. But they let it happen when the media just says things like they're fine, they're peaceful, and they do whatever they want.
I'm going to show TV viewers that they're listening an article here. Eyewitness photographs show Keith Scott handgun during Charlotte police shooting by a police officer who's black. And then if you look at it, there's video stills where he has the gun. There's shots of him with a gun in his hand and what happened there. So, again, we've all run into power-tripping cops. We've all run into power-tripping bouncers. But, you know, you walk in a bar or whatever, at least when I was in college, you know, most of the time the bouncers weren't starting to fight with you. But are there some bad bouncers? Absolutely. Are there some bad cops? Is there bad governments? You bet. Are the cops bad in North Korea? You bet they are. I've been trying to keep our cops from becoming authoritarian.
Yeah, let's talk about that for a minute. If anybody should be, anti-cop or whatever, it should theoretically be you, right? I mean, how many times have you been attacked by police? When we were in Dallas, they were throwing people up the sheriff's department. They were attacking us and punching you. And it's not like, though, we're going to sit here and say, all cops are horrible. They're terrible. Yeah, there are bad cops.
Well, they were ordered by the Democrat Party-run sheriff, El Goblo or whatever her name is, to go after us.
Right, but the thing is, it would be silly to say all cops are bad because of some bad instances.
Yeah, if the Klan goes out and kills some poor black person, we don't then say all white people are doing it.
Exactly. And but
the same thing, even if the cop was bad, why blame? Because it's about divide and conquer. Anthony, you go ahead and take over, my friend. Great job. Nightly News tonight, 7 o'clock Central, InfoWarsNews.com. Big debate coverage coming up Monday for 4 hours, right through the live debate. We're going to carry the whole thing, so won't be interrupting much because we can actually just carry the feed and not just cover it with fair use. And Anthony Gucciardi is coming up straight ahead after this break. Infowars.com. The internet gets taken over by the UN in T-minus 9 days. And the election is 46 days out. I'm Alex Jones. I'll see you back tomorrow, 11 a.m. Anthony's taking over.
The devil and attack white people. It is a silly notion, right? Because, yeah, sure, there are bad cops. And I've experienced them. I went to the NSA and got arrested by the NSA police, who told me that their dog, their military German Shepherd, was going to bite my testicles off. Okay, I've experienced the bad side, so-called bad side of law enforcement, right? But I've also experienced amazing law enforcement officers. I've also had bad experiences with different groups of people from different places and different belief systems. But that doesn't mean I chastise and attack every single one of them that belong to that group, right? So it's total ridiculousness. Now, we got a lot of news here, and one of the things I want to talk about is this Saudi Arabia deal. But we're going to talk about how Mark Zuckerberg aims to cure, prevent, and manage all disease. So he has this idea. He thinks he's going to cure and manage all disease. Chinese hackers take over moving Tesla from 12 miles away, which demonstrates how easy it is to take over vehicles. They're actually driving, and they brake, and they smash, and like, think about the implications of that. And young Britons living in suspended adulthood, over 40% are still living with their parents under 30, and a lot more. But first, what I wanted to talk about is it's kind of like the system right now is kind of like a realtor showing you a house. And you go into this house. It's a nice, beautiful, big house, it seems. And you go in, and there's like a wall that's just totally crumbled in the back, and there's roaches running around and stuff. And they're like, well, don't look at that. That's not what you need to look at. Look over there. Look over there. There's a scratch in the bathroom. That's kind of, we'll take care of that. That's the ridiculousness right now when you see Hillary Clinton and you see any politician talk about things like women's rights or gender equality or racism when they're forgetting that the wall is completely destroyed and crumbled in the back. That's what I want to talk about. So this article, U.S. lawmakers failed to block arms sales to Saudi Arabia. Okay, so billions of dollars of weapons sent to Saudi Arabia. Senators, they voted 71-27 to kill legislation that would have stopped the sale. All right. We support Saudi Arabia. Hillary loves Saudi Arabia. But gender equality and neutrality is good. Now, I brought Margaret in here because I want to go in over some articles with her, and we were talking about this earlier. So she's going to join us for the segment, Margaret Howell. And we're going to talk about how friendly Saudi Arabia is. I've got some articles over here. Because, you see, I actually do care about human empowerment. And human empowerment also pertains to females. Who would have thought, right? And female empowerment is important. It is good. It is actually essential if we're going to do anything with our life, right? So what's funny, though, isn't it funny, that they talk about all of this while supporting Saudi Arabia, while saying nothing about the injustices, while saying nothing about so many different injustices about women that we should actually talk about, such as 9 things women can't do in Saudi Arabia. How about talk about some gender equality here? Drive a car. There's no official law that bans women from driving, but deeply held religious beliefs prohibit it. Interact with men, wear clothes, go for a swim, compete freely in sports. Does that sound like equality to you?
You know it does, Anthony. I mean, that just sounds like perfection and heaven on earth, not being able to interact with men, drive a car, or swim. Of course not. Of course that's grossly unequal. And, you know, we're talking about archaic people. I'm sorry, but we're talking about a way of life, this extreme Wahhabism. I've reported from the Middle East, never from Saudi Arabia, but there is an oppressive feeling in the air if you're a woman walking out in public showing your hair, even as a Westerner. I mean,
yeah, I don't think it's just in the air. I mean, you can't interact with men.
You cannot interact with men.
Women are required to limit the amount of time spent with men to whom they are not related. okay. Wear clothes or makeup. And then this Washington Post article that I found. On page 3 of this, it says, the facts and few myths about Saudi Arabia and human rights, okay? And remember, politicians in the United States telling you you're bad, I'm going to point at you in the camera, you're bad, okay? You're bad because you use terms that could offend someone. You say male and female. You're against gender equality. You're bad. Oh, but listen to this, though. It says, hey, you know, while Saudi Arabia is dominated by ultra-conservative Sunni ideology, an estimated 15% of the country's Muslims are Shiite. They say they face discrimination, but, you know, don't worry. It says some of the areas are actually more liberal. It says in more liberal areas of the country, such as Jeddah, the dress code for women is relatively relaxed. How is it relaxed? Brightly covered abayas can be worn, or sometimes the cloak is worn to show the clothes underneath.
Uh-oh.
Sometimes you can show the clothes you're wearing. And while they can't, you know, women can't legally drive without licenses, some women and women in the southern provinces often are allowed to drive sometimes.
That so is awesome.
It's more liberal. It says more relaxed. Mm-hmm. So it's okay. Welcome back. It's the 4th hour of the Alex Jones Show. I am Anthony Gucciardi, and we got a stack of news to go over, including some news that just got brought in to me from Paul Joseph Watson. And we're going to play his video, The Truth About Charlotte, up here in a couple minutes. Bizarre message plays on hacked radio station. This is on Infowars.com. Trump will go on the 26th. Says, this is seriously freaky. A man driving on the New Jersey Turnpike recorded a bizarre radio message that repeatedly stated the words, quote, Trump will go 26th, leading some to speculate that the station had been hacked. A YouTube clip features the weird voice playing over and over again as the driver expresses his bafflement. What is this, he asked, turning the stereo off before turning it back on and hearing the message once again. So who knows what that is? Could be a total scam. Could be some type of real threat. Here, let's listen. So, you know, that kind of stuff happens from time to time. And, like, internet countdowns and stuff. Like, you go to a website and it'll be a countdown, like, warning, on this day it'll happen, you know. Who knows what it really is? But it is pretty interesting. Let me also remind you that we have extended Super Male Vitality Mega Special for, I guess, an additional day now because of the fact that, number one, when we first pulled it, people actually emailed in by the thousands and said, please extend it. And, you know, it's humbling. It's kind of an amazing thing to think about that people really wanted to take advantage of the special. So Super Male Vitality is 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. And the truth of the matter is, as I always say, you can choose to support Starbucks with your coffee every morning. You can choose to support Walmart with your clothing that costs more than the supplements and nutraceuticals at InfoWarsLife.com. Or you can choose to support meaningful content, people that care, people that actually want to do something, people that actually have similar ideological beliefs as you, and groups that will use your money to fuel all of that. So InfoWarsLife.com, Super Male Vitality is 20% off. And I wanted to read one of these reviews. I think Alex touched on it earlier, but just think about this. There's thousands of reviews like this. Many, many five stars on InfoWarsLife.com. It says, 43 but feeling 21 from Dr. P from Connecticut. It says, seemingly impossible results in minimal time. Working 80 to 90 hours a week, I was beginning to feel run down. 2 weeks of taking Super Male Vitality, and I feel the energy and enthusiasm that I had when I was 21. Okay, these aren't made up. This is through a third-party review website. It's all vetted, all legit on InfoWarsLife.com. And Super Male Vitality, it's the last chance to get it for 20% off. Support an operation that actually cares about you and get something that also is really good for you and works. It's a win-win. Also, let's get into some news now. So when I talk about things like Saudi Arabia, and I talk about Saudi Arabia's vast injustice and the fact that they cut limbs off as a form of punishment, or the fact they kill you, even if you use words like democracy or freedom or something, they could come after you and actually sever your fingers or lash you or something. Okay. Does that mean that I'm anti-Muslim? No. When I talk about rioters in Charlotte beating up a white person because he's white or saying that all white people are the devil, does that mean I'm a racist? No. And I will not conform to the ideological prison of political correctness, which is actually complete BS. See, I'm not in that gate. I'm not in the paradigm in which I have to conform to fake ideological standards and word domination cast upon me by the media system that thinks they're in control when they're not. I'm not actually going to do it because there's a key to your cell and it's sitting right here. And I am long out of my cell. So I'm not going to conform to that. And that's why I'm going to talk about this. The United Arab Emirates is going to start taking in Syrian refugees. So this was on a bunch of news sites this morning. The Emirates will begin welcoming refugees over the next 5 years. In a major shift, the UAE has announced that it will take in 15,000 Syrian refugees over the next 5 years. It says currently around 250,000 Syrians live in the UAE, but none of them have refugee status. And I saw in the comments that this was being celebrated, like, oh, I'm so happy that they're taking in these refugees. You know, Saudi Arabia has like tents, cities with hundreds of thousands of empty tents they could live in. But, you know, people are saying, oh, this is so good, right? Now, if you go on to Reddit, which is a great open source style website, it's really just human beings talking and commenting on things. I came across some interesting comments that were among the top voted up by thousands of other users. Now, of course, this is just someone's writings that have not been 100% shown, but I'll tell you what, these are based on a lot of news stories. So you look at that story and you say, oh, that's so great, they're taking in the refugees. But the problem is, again, we actually have to investigate things. We have to look further. And here's just some comments from people that are really deep, from people that have lived in Dubai and know what it's like. This one is from media-n on Reddit. It says, in the UAE, unless your father is an Emirati, you are not an Emirati and will never be a citizen there. What many of these rich Arab countries do is they have generation and generations of Syrians living in their country, but no matter how long they've been there, no matter if they were born there, their parents born there, their grandparents born there, they will never be Emirati and always be Syrian, always second-class citizens. Many laborers and many are treated like pure garbage. These numbers are inflated heavily due to the fact they count people as Syrian, even though perhaps no one in their family has ever been to Syria, leading all the way back to the grandparents. The UAE just doesn't want to dilute their purity, and no one is ever allowed to become a citizen unless they are of pure blood. I lived in Dubai for a while. You want to know what a very racist society feels like? Go live in Dubai or Qatar or Bahrain, where your skin color, your ethnicity decides your social status. Yeah, you know, people seem to forget. Because remember, the house, the realtor is selling us this house, and there's a collapsed wall in the back. But don't worry about that. The roaches are scurrying in, like the mold is coming in. No, no. Don't worry about that. Go look how nice the place is. Everything's fine. There's a scratch in the bathroom. So in the world, in the planet, on the planet that we live on, there is actual atrocity where you are ranked. Your social status is you're born into a family and the color of your skin and your last name and your generation history is your social class. Okay. It's not like in the United States, where the social justice warriors get mad if you post something on Twitter that offends someone because you didn't use a gender-neutral term. Instead, it's real life, okay? So these things actually happen. And we, over here, are so closed off all this, and we're just so set in this system. It's like, oh, we must blame everyone else for our problems, and every little minute thing is the issue. Actually, things like this happen. It goes on. Emiratis are one of the most racist people in the world, and this is not some grand gesture by them. This is purely for recognition, and those numbers are inflated beyond belief. What they took in were very wealthy Syrians and Syrians living in other Gulf Coast countries that were never part of the crises. Now, I'm not going to sit here and say everyone in the UAE is racist, clearly. Okay, that's a statement by this Redditor. Another one goes on, not only but vulnerable people in the UAE can be in extreme danger, and nobody will care for their plight, and the abusers will get away with it. He says, four Emirati men kidnapped an Ethiopian maid, gang raped her twice in different locations, and ran her over with a car, and then proceeded to stone her to death with large rocks, which smashed her. This is disturbing, okay? After paying 200,000 dirhams, which is $50,000 U.S., blood money in total, they were released from prison. One of the attackers, 13 years prior, had raped and murdered a Pakistani little girl, but her father, who was an imam, forgave him. And they linked all the stories about that. Okay, so in a happy little fake world where we have to, everything is great, they're taking in Syrian refugees, it's so good, that's great, we can celebrate that. But in real life, remember, there are much worse things actually going on. Now, what I want to do, speaking of the truth about circumstances, is go ahead and play Paul Watson's video, The Truth About Charlotte. And remember, it's not bad to talk about the details of things and the importance of things. Doesn't mean you're racist against everybody, okay? It means that you actually want to identify things and talk about them. Let's go to this video.
Harmonious Black Lives Matter activists staged a peaceful protest in Charlotte last night, but were brutally tear-gassed by racist cops. Oh, wait a second. Physically attacking reporters is not a legitimate form of protest. Shooting each other is not a legitimate form of protest. Stealing and looting cash registers from local businesses is not a legitimate form of protest. Trying to set journalists on fire is not a legitimate form of protest. Throwing rocks off bridges at passing vehicles full of families is not a legitimate form of protest. Beating up innocent people in underground parking lots because they're white is not a legitimate form of protest. Smashing up apartment windows where black people live to protest in favor of Black Lives Matter is not a legitimate form of protest. Smashing up buses that poor black people rely on to get to their jobs is not a legitimate form of protest. Looting the Charlotte Hornets team store so you can steal basketball merchandise is not a legitimate form of protest. Stealing sneakers is not a legitimate form of protest. Attempting to hijack cars and terrify their innocent occupants is not a legitimate form of protest. But how did MSNBC report on all this? By calling the rioters peaceful.
The people that are out here protesting, they're hugging and they're like, they're being very peaceful.
We were following this crowd that was largely peaceful.
Mostly peaceful.
We've also seen some sweet scenes of protesters hugging one another and praying. Mostly a group of peaceful protesters.
Peaceful, 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 peaceful.
And that's why 94% of Americans don't trust the mainstream media. What's unfolding in Charlotte is objectively, manifestly, provably not a protest. It's a violent, unjustified riot by criminals, gang members, and thugs. Why is the media giving it legitimacy by still referring to it as a protest? If mobs of white supremacists were looting stores, setting fires, attacking journalists, and shooting guns, would the media call it a protest? But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe all this was completely justified because another racist white police officer killed an innocent unarmed black man who was merely carrying a book. Oh wait, he was actually killed by a black cop.
All white people are devils.
But what kind of book was he carrying? Paperback? Hardcover? Oh no, it was a 9mm gun. Well, imagine my shock. So a black cop shoots an armed black thug with a criminal record, and then a black protester shoots another black protester. Yeah, must be white people's fault. I guess it's my fault for not checking my privilege. And how did de facto Black Lives Matter leader D-Ray McKesson respond to the riots, the looting, the bloodshed, the mayhem, the violence? By tweeting, "We stand with you," because nothing says justice like destroying your own city and living up to the very stereotype about black people that you constantly complain about. Barack Obama also stands with this group, while billionaire white elitist George Soros bankrolls it to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars. Hillary Clinton has promised to change laws for them. They advocate killing cops. They've inspired mass murderers who have killed black cops. Their ideological guru is a convicted cop killer on the FBI's most wanted terrorist list. They've built an entire movement based around the completely fraudulent narrative that there's a racist war against black people being waged by cops. It's manifestly, provably not true. This is what they're protesting against, while none of them give a damn about this. Thanks to Black Lives Matter, more black people are killing each other because cops refuse to patrol these areas. Black Lives Matter is poison. It's doing incredible harm to race relations in America. It's giving gang member thugs an excuse to carry out criminal rampages. And it's resulting in more black people being killed by other black people. How many more cities need to burn before this reality is realized?
Peaceful, 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 peaceful.
Peaceful, peaceful, peaceful protesters. You know, it's division, division, division. The further we're divided, what happens is everyone has raw rage. They're primarily upset about everything that's happening in the world, in the country, in life, okay? They're primarily upset. And the thing is that the system of control, call it whatever you will, maybe it's the media, maybe it is the corporate interests, maybe it's whatever, maybe it's just an organic thing that comes together, like a massive biome, okay, that just wants to vie for control. It knows that you can target that raw hatred. And instead of targeting the raw hatred at the cause, kind of like treating a disease, you can target that raw hatred at something else, a scapegoat. You can go ahead and instead of telling people, like I said, the house, instead of looking at the crumbling wall, you can say, well, look over there, look at something else. And that is what happens when you say, see, the police are the enemy, or see, the protesters are the enemy. Everyone is the enemy, but the root cause. Every single one is the enemy, but the root cause. So that is how you completely stifle production. You can completely stifle progress. You completely stifle any form of intellectual renaissance happening because people are too busy loading up their heads with preconceived notions and funneling that raw hatred and energy towards the side that they've been told is bad. And then we wonder why people are living in suspended adulthood, like this research finds. Young Britons living in suspended adulthood, research finds. From The Guardian, significant number of under 30s lack self-confidence and are at risk of mental health problems, with women worst affected, says report. Despair, worries about the future, and financial pressures are taking a toll on millions of young Britons, according to a poll which found young women in particular were suffering. Low pay and lack of work in today's Britain are resulting in suspended adulthood, with many living or moving back in with their parents and putting off having children, according to the poll. Large numbers describe themselves as worn down, 42%, lacking self-confidence, 47%, and feeling worried about the future, 51%. Yeah, 70% of the United States is worried about the future and doesn't like the direction the country's heading either. Says the Young Women's Trust, the charity that commissioned the polling by Populous Data Solutions, warned that Britain was facing a, quote, generation of young people in crisis, as it called on the government to take steps, including creating a minister with responsibility for overall youth policy. And here's the thing. All these problems, from people wanting to ride on the street, to the youth feeling like they are crap and having no self-worth and having no jobs and everything, isn't just going to be fixed by promoting a minister of the government for youth services or whatever, okay? This is, it's not like they just need to sit down and talk to somebody. It's a core problem. All of this is stemming from it. All of this is stemming from it. Yet we fail over and over again to address the issues. We fail so many, so many times. Instead, we could be doing things like going to Mars. We could be doing things like expanding the planet. We could be doing so much other great things. Senate panel authorizes money for Mars mission shuttle replacement, for example. So Hillary Clinton does not want to, according to information I read, continue to fund NASA. Believe it or not, Trump is the candidate that wants to fund NASA. So they know this, and the Senate is already authorizing an additional mission. With a new president on the horizon, a key Senate committee moved Wednesday to protect longstanding priorities of the nation's space program from the potential upheaval of an incoming administration. Members of the Commerce, Science, and Transportation Committee passed a bipartisan bill authorizing $19.5 billion to continue work on a Mars mission and efforts to send astronauts on private rockets to the ISS from U.S. soil, regardless of shifting political winds. See, these are the things we should be focusing on, not whether or not someone is going to be triggered by a word we didn't even intend to be. Final segment, it's the Alex Jones Show, and I am Anthony Gucciardi, and we're going to talk about this story right here. New report finds chemical in U.S. drinking water that they actually don't even test for affects hundreds of millions of Americans, and some interesting thoughts on that. First, I do want to remind you again, Super Male Vitality Mega Sale is going to end most likely tonight on InfoWarsLife.com. 20% off Super Male Vitality, and you can also get 20% off Secret 12 Vitamin B12, which is excellent. And we did extend this sale because people said they really, really wanted it to be extended. They didn't get a chance. Maybe they didn't get paid yet or whatever. They didn't have the cash. It is 20% off. Stock up now. Super Male Vitality is the real deal. It works. I've even used it consistently throughout the past few years, and I've gone in and out of kind of getting in better shape, working out again, eating properly, and I think I feel the best my whole life right now. And I'll tell you what, it is the real deal, and so are the rest of the supplements. InfoWarsLife.com. Support something you believe in. Now let's talk about this. So first of all, Mark Zuckerberg, according to this piece, Priscilla Chan and Mark Zuckerberg aim to, quote, cure, prevent, and manage all disease. Couple plans to invest $3 billion over next decade to help scientists develop and utilize tools such as artificial intelligence and blood monitors to treat illnesses. They say, can we cure, prevent, or manage all disease by the end of the century, he asks, speaking in front of a packed lecture theater at the University of California. The Chan-Zuckerberg initiative will focus on some of the world's biggest killers, including heart disease, cancer, infectious disease, and neurological diseases. One of its biggest investments is to be a $600 million biohub at UCF, which will bring together scientists and engineers. Second focus will be transformative technology, all of which will be made available to all scientists everywhere. Now, let's talk about that. So, sounds very interesting. Sounds reminiscent of a Elysium thing that you can get in. It cures everything, right? Why are we still focusing, not to put down billions of dollars in this interesting concept, why are we still focusing as a whole, though, on treating as opposed to actually looking at why it's happening in the first place? Sure, we know some of the factors, but things like this, it's like we're going to spend all this money. It's like when you check out at a store and they say, would you like to give $5 to cancer research? Well, you know, how about we talk about this kind of stuff first? New report finds, quote, Aaron Brockovich chemical in U.S. drinking water. Dangerous levels of chromium-6 are contaminating tap water consumed by hundreds of millions of Americans, according to a national report released Tuesday. The agency has never set a specific limit for chromium-6 in drinking water. There's scientific uncertainty regarding safe levels of this chemical in drinking water and possible long-term consequences of ingestion. David Knight gave this to me before I got on the show, by the way. It's really interesting. But this new analysis comes from the Environmental Working Group, an independent advocacy group, examines evidence from water systems throughout the nation and concludes that the tap of 218 million Americans contains levels of chromium-6. Now, here's the key thing, okay? The EWG rep says, Americans are exposed to dozens, if not hundreds, of other cancer-causing chemicals every day in their drinking water, their consumer products, and their foods. And what the best science of the last decade tells us is that these chemicals, acting in combination with each other, can be more dangerous than exposure to a single chemical. Exactly. They all interact differently in the body and together before entering the body. So when we drink tap water full of junk and contaminants, gee, what is happening? Or we eat food that is laced with contaminants. We're forgetting the root intake source. We're forgetting that. It's like if you had a boat filled with water, you wouldn't just get as many buckets as possible and dump it out. You'd say, why is it filling with water? Let's fill up the hole in which the water is coming from. Instead of, would you like to donate money to purchase more buckets to remove the water from the boat? A charitable donation today, and you're like, well, fill up the hole. It's filling with water because there's a hole in it. Would you like to donate to purchase more buckets for charity to remove water from the boat, right? It's a silly concept. We need to actually look at what's happening in the first place. Just like everything else in the world, right? It has been the Alex Jones Show, fourth hour. Thank you for joining. InfoWarsLife.com, 20% off Supermail and Secret 12. And thanks for your support, regardless, watching the show, spreading the news.